Hello, hello, everybody. How are you guys doing today? It is me, your bear bud, Dae, and welcome to today's stream. How is everybody doing this fine morning? If it's not morning for you, how are you doing on this fine day? I am doing pretty good. I finally got to sleep in. Finally get my rest after the whole work week. Hello, Jack. I pretend we were not just speaking over in Shaggy's chat. I'm EB. Well, go sleepy then. Take a nap. Just take a little rest, a little power nap. But yeah, earlier I was in watching Shaggy's stream. Did y'all know that there was new biomes coming out in Minecraft? Because I sure as hell didn't. So when I got in there and Shaggy was like, oh yeah, it's like cherry blossom biome. I was like, what? I did not hear of that at all. So yeah, I'm gonna have to be playing some Minecraft here soon. You're at work. Well, take a nap. That's never stopped me. Just take a nap. Just find a nice little dark corner where nobody passes through. So, you know, get comfortable and then zone out, you know? It's as simple as that. I'm glad I finally got to sleep today. I ran out of rain, so I'm drinking cappuccino. More energy, more caffeine. Oh my gosh, I forgot to bring up a drink. Well, it's because I didn't have any drinks. I'm waiting for my gold peak to cool down. I only have room in my fridge for one 6-pack of gold peak tea, and I just finished the first pack today. Actually, it was the second pack, but you know, shh, it's fine. So I'm waiting for the others to cool down so then I can bring one up. They're extra sweet. My favorite. We'll feel like I'm dying, but you know what? At least I'll be happy. And yeah, I also had me a burger for breakfast. The perfect breakfast, a burger.
I can't wait to find out why Mr. Holden is being sus and scream that I fucking knew it.
Listen, you might be disappointed. It's not really that deep of an answer. But, you know, at least you'll get to figure out, learn what he might be doing this time around. I feel like... Is it every step that he does something to annoy Cove? Like, you'll see, the first step was, like, trying to buy a kid's friendship.
I will find a way to make it deep.
Yeah, you... Like, the last step, you're like, oh my god. One of your moms is gonna cheat on your other mom with Mr. Holden. And I was like, oh my god. Jack's going in it. You know what? Whatever makes you happy. You know what? We'll give some more dark, edgy flavor to the story. It'll be good. It'll be great. But yes, we will be playing Step 2 today, so we are now 13 years old in the story. I finally remember the ages. It goes 5 years each step, so we were 8 in the previous step, and now we are 13, and then we'll be 18 in the third step. And then, I think 23 in the DLC. Well, you know how it is. Y'all know math. Y'all know math better than I do. But yes, let me go ahead and unmute this. You want me to?
Jack Twist.
Jack Twist, indeed, yes. The Jack Twist. The Jack Spice, you know? Now let's pan on over. Alright, so every time a new step occurs, we get to change our appearance again because, you know, as you grow older, your appearances usually change. Mine didn't for, like, a good decade or two. But, you know, it'd be like that. Well, it'll change in here, so let's see. So we can at least change... I don't think we can change our skin tone. Yeah, that makes sense. But we can change our face shape. So in case we gain weight or lose weight and stuff like that. Oh, a little peach head. Ooh, felt. Mm-hmm. Swear, yeah. I think we'll stick with round. I don't think we've really lost the little innocent chubby face yet. And we can't change... We can change the eye shape, too. So you know what? To show that we are getting older. No more bottom eyelashes. They're gone. No longer adorable. And then maybe our hair has changed. Getting older, maybe get it chopped. Let's see. Oh, I need to be reminded what all hairstyles are in here. Oh yeah, and show you guys too, in case you want to play this on your own. These are the hairstyles you can have. They have a good variety of hairstyles. Which I really like. Switch up your looks and all that. Let's see. Yeah, this is the back hair. And of course, you can also, like, dye the hair as well. Have little two-toned hairs. Ooh. Oh, I like that. That's kind of like my hair. Interesting. Let's see, I think... maybe a nice little chopped it back. Oh my, the mane. Right? Have some luscious hair. Let's see, what's the front? Here's the front hairs as well. I mean, honestly, I don't really change the front hair that often. I'm a creature of habit. I stay the same. Change my hairstyle once every like 5 years. Oh yeah, and there's the two-toned hairs. I think. Okay, yeah, so whatever two-tone you get, it stays the same, but you can change the other side of the hair. Yeah. Fun fact, I have never dyed my hair before. My hair has always been the same, but I've been asked before if I have ever dyed my hair, because it's such a dark color. I know it's a little bit lighter on here, but that's just because, you know, the sun's hitting my hair on stream, but... in real life, it's actually pretty dark, and people be like, oh, do you dye your hair? And it's like, no, never. Hey, you want to see? I got gray hairs already. Oh. Shaved. What if we did this hair? Up in all sorts of bright colors. Nice. I've been tempted to dye my hair, but I don't know. It's like, I've gone so long without doing it, it's kind of like, oh my gosh. I'm afraid to rip the band-aid. Okay, yeah, I think we'll stick to this hair. Chopped hair. And then, ooh. Thin. I don't think they're thin. I think thick. Oh, there's two. Only two options. Thin or thick lips. No in between. I have grays too. We all got stress. I swear. Large hand size. Okay, we'll do a medium hand size. And then... oh, do they have my scar? No. They don't have my nose scar. I guess we'll... do eyebrow. Blame my grandfather. It's like, look what you did to me, old man. How could you? And there's freckles again, and then we can get acne. If we so desired. I don't know why anybody would want acne. Before, like, the little realism. Oh, get a little birthmark. Yeah. He was full gray at 40. Your genetics have hurt me in this way. Oh yes, we can also get earrings, too. See, do they have my earrings? They got little stars. Oh, there's a little one right there. But you can't see it. No, I'll do this one, even though we can't see it right now. And, I don't know, I don't know if I have thick, or if my lips are thinner or thicker. I'll just go with in. It doesn't really matter. Change the page. It's still the same, but, you know, getting more into accessories. Can I have braces? No thanks. And then... we're a little rambunctious. Maybe we have some arm scars. I can't even see the difference, right? So it don't really matter. Okay, I think we're good. Done. Let's get into it. Oh, yes. And our feelings for Cove, let's go ahead and just move on up. It's a little crush. Maybe a little... I'd still be pretty relaxed about it. Getting older, we've been friends for so long, things are changing. You never know. I'm wondering if I hit ready. Okay, yeah, that's fine. Oh, and we can customize Cove as well. I was wondering, since this is the step where, actually in this step, a lot of new characters get introduced, but one of the characters you can have another route for is introduced in this step, so I was wondering if maybe it would make us, like, choose our, like, feelings towards this person as well, but I guess not. I guess they save that for another step. Interesting. I'm wondering how we even activate it, huh? I guess we'll see. Alright, choose. Let's see. You know, so basically in this portion, we can choose to pick what his personality, what Cove's personality and appearance looks like. Or we can just let whatever the game decides. You know, we'll leave it up to fate. We'll let them decide what he looks like. Neither. Oh, here it is. Okay. Choose your feelings for Derek. This is how you feel towards Derek for this step. It can be the same or different from how you feel towards Cove. Oh my gosh, we can have crush on two people at once? I mean, he'd be like, oh, why do I look like that? He's like, Derek. Okay, we're pretty fond of him. Very direct about it. We're friends. This time around. Until we finish this round. Who the fuck is Derek? You'll find out. You won't meet him. Yes, he's the other romanceable character in this game. I haven't played his route. Once we're done with Cove's, we'll do his next, since he gets introduced before the other one is. Alright, we're ready. Are you sure? Yeah. Well, friends. August ended. September began. It was time to go back to school. Lizzie groaned and complained the entire first week. She hated going to classes. Still, there are interesting things to do that couldn't be done anywhere else. I think this monologue is for, like, immediately after the summer of the first step that we played. You weren't sure how Ko felt about it. He was enrolled that year. That was like a sign Ko would be staying in Sunset Bird for a while. At school, he was alright, but he kept his distance from the other kids, from what you saw anyway. Whenever he could, Ko stuck to you like glue. He didn't even mind that much what you did to pass the time, as long as it was together. Sometimes it was like things were exactly the same as when you had first met. But other times, as you get older, you couldn't ignore how the feelings had changed in meaningful ways. He had us. That year, the divorce of Ko's parents was finalized. You overheard your parents talking about it, saying Ko's dad got full custody. At first, you worried that meant bad news. It made Mr. Holden cry, apparently. Then you found out it meant Ko would keep living with his dad. He would only stay with his mom a few weeks of the year. Ko cried too, for different reasons, you thought. It seemed like Cove and his dad might move again, but Mr. Holden decided to stay after all. Mom asked him about it once. He said he didn't want to uproot Cove's life a second time. Imagine Cove crying, like, oh god damn it, I have to keep living with my dad. Mr. Holden tried to get Cove to like Sunset Bird more. He kept encouraging his son to go out and see the place. Sometimes Mr. Holden volunteered you to spend time with Cove. He seemed very confident that it was an effective strategy. Cove never talked to anyone about what happened with his parents, and withdrew whenever it was brought up. It was hard for him, yet nobody knew how to help. Eventually, Cove stopped crying on his own. You couldn't understand what had changed. He got over it, that's what. Sway in your face. But you hoped that you could help him feel better still, since even without the tears, he looked sad. Maybe one day he could say out loud what he felt inside. After that, it felt like things had gone back to normal, except what was normal didn't stay the same. Years passed, and suddenly you were in middle school. You weren't a kid anymore. You were 13 years old. That officially made you a teen, even if your sister didn't agree. Still a child. Hell, get ready for the worst years of life. Middle school is hell. Like, elementary, it was all fun and sunshine. High school, it's like, you're trying to figure yourself out. But in middle school, all hell breaks loose. Kids are brutal. The toys and crayons that used to litter every free space in your room had been packed away somewhere, replaced by new hobbies. There were other changes, too. Ko's cast was taken off. It was weird to see him without it initially. Underneath the pink plaster ended up being a long, thin scar that snaked across his forearm. Ko's chest puffed out in pride when someone drew attention to it. He also went through a major growth spurt. He was the tallest student in his class for 2 years in a row. Ko will probably hold that spot again next time. In class, people knew him for more than just being tall. He also stood out because of how well he did on tests and in other academic situations. Over the years, he began opening up more, too. You saw him talking amicably with other kids or neighbors from time to time. Yeah, so with the personality, you can either have him be more athletic or more academic. So I guess, depending on the choices we made last time, he went more down the academic route. He's a little smart cookie. Unlike me. And the only kid that came to visit the neighborhood when you were little, Shiloh, well, he was gone. He and his mom moved back to South because of her work, just 1 year after Ko came to Sunset Bird. It had been really upsetting when he left. Lizzie was inconsolable for weeks, but nobody talked about Shiloh anymore. It was a long time ago. You learned some heartbreaking things and became less sad the further away they were, even if they had never gotten any better. That was sad in its own way. Things at home were different too. You still lived in the same house and all that, but it wasn't how it was before. Ma dyed her hair purple, wanting something new, and liked it so much she kept dyeing it. You remember calling her mommy as a kid, but something like that seemed awkward nowadays. You were much too old for the word. Lizzie felt too mature for her nickname, too. She insisted on everyone calling her Elizabeth, so you did. Your mom soon gave her permission to go places. Ooh, oh my goodness, thank you so much. James Morningstar for the follow. Thank you, thank you. I hope you enjoy your time here. Welcome amongst the rest of the bear buds. We're just now playing through the step two of Our Life Beginning in Always. Getting through the intro now. Where'd I leave off? Your mom soon gave her permission to go other places other than the playground and shopping street, which she took advantage of. You really saw her around the old neighborhood. In fact, she hardly spent time with you the way she did before. Elizabeth instead associated more and more girls with school who were her own age. Maybe the difference between 13 and 15 was greater than the difference between 8 and 10. You started befriending new people yourself, like Derek Suarez. See, here's Derek now. He's coming. He didn't live in the neighborhood or go to the same school. What happened was his and Cove's dad struck up a business partnership a few months ago. Since then, Derek would pop up in the area now and then. I see Mr. Suarez was happy to let Derek tag along to his work, if Derek had the time for it. Oh, so I wonder now, since I haven't played this since Derek's DLC came out, I wonder if we're actually going to be able to see his dad now, because before, he was just a name. He was just, like, there in the background. He didn't really have any lines or anything. But since then, you know, he's got his own, like, sprite model, his own, you know, expressions, and probably, like, dialogue now, so I wonder how much changes will be within this step. I wonder if we'll get new events, too, that are just Derek-specific. I guess we'll see. Without a doubt, everyone and everything around you had changed, in small and big ways. You had to. As time went by, though, it was easy to settle into this new normal. And before you knew it, school was over and summer vacation had come again. And here we are, back in our room. It's changed. It was the first day of summer vacation.
I haven't seen him yet, but I'm already prepared to fight Mr. Holden.
He's there. He's lurking. I'm doing very well, James. Thank you very much. I hope you too are doing well. It was the first day of summer vacation. The sun was as hot as ever, but you were inside and away from its harsh rays. As you can see, Jack is very untrusting of Mr. Holden in this game. But, yeah, we'll get to see what he's up to, you know? No, this isn't. I haven't played the two DLC that's come out. I haven't played Derek and Baxter's DLC. Well, this is my first time streaming it, though, so we're going through Cove's route. And then when we're done with Cove's route, we'll go do and do the other characters as well. I'm glad to hear you're doing well. I'm gonna beat him up. Well, save your fist, Jack. We ain't there yet. It was the first day of summer vacation. The sun was as hot as ever, but you were inside and away from its harsh rays. To be more specific, you were. What do you think of Baxter and Derek? Well, let's see. When I played before, I liked Derek. I think he was a good character from what we've seen him. Of course, when I played it, he just only appeared in the second step and like a phone call in the third step. But I like him. I think he's a good character. I'm excited to see. I think I'm more excited for his route than I am for Baxter's. I think I like more of the, I don't know. Derek kind of has a little bit of a golden retriever energy with his, because he's very nice and he's also into like the sports as well. It has been a hot minute though, but you know, he's all right. I'm excited for his. As for Baxter, I don't know. I don't think I really knew what to make with him. I'm not really drawn to like the rich boy characters, but I'm still interested to see what happens. I've seen on Twitter that a lot of people really like Baxter's route. And for what those things I've did hurt, it seems like it might be a little different from the other two's route, just a little bit, depending. It seems like there might be a little bit more angst in there compared to like Cove's and Derek's, maybe. Like I said, I don't know what Derek's is, but I'm assuming from what I've heard. I'm very interested. I'm very excited. Yes, it's definitely more angsty. Oh, yeah. All right. I'm glad that's confirmed then. So that will be interesting to see. We'll spice it up just a little bit. A little cheese. You want the Cheez-Its? Where is...
it's a chance.
Oh, yeah, James, since you are new here, we do have a little redeem of a gift snack slash drink. I have these little assets, these little images, that when you redeem it, you can pick which snack we have on the stream that we give to our little buddy BB down here. And here, this time, we have Beezit. Well, as the VA for Baxter, I'm happy you're at least excited for his DLC, and I thank you for giving his character a chance to win your- Oh, you're the VA? Oh my gosh, wow, nice! Well, I'm glad- Wow, I'm kind of honored that you're here watching right now, thank you. Yeah, like I said, I'm not typically drawn to, like, the rich boy characters, but, you know, like I said, I'm still interested. He didn't turn me off in no way. Yeah, thank you so- Oh my gosh, I'm getting a little nervous now. The VA has arrived. But yes, welcome, welcome. And yes, here is the Cheez-Its. Is Will. Brownies, alright. More snacks. So I was planning on doing Derek's route after we finish Cove, since Derek is Ah! Shit. My display. Ah! Stop that! Give me the brownies! Since Derek is introduced before Baxter, so I hope you'll be able to attend the streams in the future when we get to Baxter.
I will be full today.
BB is very happy. We also have a little TTS redeem as well. Man, that was such like a twist there. Caught me off guard. Yeah, nice. Yes, Jack do be enjoying the TTS. It is very fun. I like it when you guys use it. I am planning on streaming Our Life once a week at least. So, and I'm planning on like finishing each step during one stream each stream session. So we should be getting into it in the next couple weeks. So we shall see. Well, yes, let's get back into it. Let's see. Alright, we were just mentioning. Also followed you on Twitter, so I can maybe more easily catch you if you just change. Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. And yeah, on Twitter as well, I'll be updating on like where we are at in the story as well. See, that is much appreciated. Thank you so much, James. I'm glad to have you here. That'll be great. Okay, so we're getting back into the summer. We are celebrating by sleeping in. It's time off. I love sleeping in. It was hot, but you still had the blanket up over your head to block out the sun. You didn't want it intruding on your lazy morning. Unfortunately, you hadn't prepared for an intrusion. From beneath the blanket, you heard the door creak open. Aw, thank you, James. I appreciate that. You are very lovely as well. Like I said, I appreciate you being here. You're still sleeping. Wow, get up. No, I'm still sleeping. I'm still tired. You stayed wrapped up in your blankets, not moving an inch with your eyes closed peacefully. By the impatient tapping of her foot, you could tell she hadn't left. Come on, I know you heard me. Get up now. I will come over there. So much for a lazy morning. Your special boy is at the door, like he always is now. He brought some happy summer gift for Mr. Holden. Mom wants you to take it from him. Say thanks or whatever. You didn't like the way she called him your special boy, but you knew by now that saying so wouldn't stop her. So come down already. All right. I'll be there when I'm there. Classic sassiness. All right. Fine, I'm coming. Elizabeth says nothing else and left without having done what was instructed of her. You roll out of bed, stretching your arms up high and yawning. Time to get ready. You set yourself in front of the mirror in the far corner of your room. Oh, this is our height, right? Your reflection hardly even fit in the frame. You're very tall. I am not very tall. Jack sleeping. Your reflection went over the whole length of the mirror. You're pretty tall. No, I'm pretty much average height. I fit right into the frame here. Although the mirrors in my house are very tall, though, so if somebody came in and they went past the mirror, then they would be, like, extremely tall. Short buddies. No, we're average. We're not short, we're just average. Ko was really tall. Derek was kind of short, and you're pretty much the exact height that someone would expect for a 13-year-old. I like my height. I don't really want to be... I wouldn't... You weren't sure how to feel about it. Maybe when I was younger, I wanted to be a lot taller, but nah, I'm pretty into my height. It's all right. Not according to Shaggy and Paul. Well, screw them. If they want to be on their high horse, they can. It suited you well in your mind, and you put the finishing touches on your outfit while ruminating the situation. Careless as they had been, Elizabeth's words piqued your curiosity. You planned on going over to see what Ko was up to today, so this worked in your favor. It was when you spotted your reflection that you realized you were smiling wide. You were looking forward to seeing him. You left your room, taking an easy time down the stairs. Step 2. Second Chance. You spotted Mom first, reclining on the couch. She held a magazine in her hands, which she had been perusing through. Morning, Mom. She looked up at your greeting, a smile instantly appearing on her face.
Thanks.
Good morning, Dae. Thank you for coming down. Uh-oh, I don't like that. what name? Thank you for coming down. Ma's at the door with Cove. He can't stay over today, unfortunately. Why don't you go and thank him before he leaves? Alright. Second Chance. Oh, okay. Who do I gotta fight? The title. You nodded and made your way to the front of the house. Just as she said, Ma was there making conversation. She must have heard you because she looked over her shoulder.
Oh.
There is her purple hair. Who out here needing a second chance? I guess we'll find out. Look who finally made it. Morning, sleepyhead. She reached forward and you knew she was about to pat you on the head. She was taller than average, so you were little in her eyes, despite being a typical size for your own age. I mean, for parents, we'll always be little. See. Push her hand back. A lot of you push her hand back and groan. We'll let her do it begrudgingly. Go, I swear to goodness. You stood by patiently and indulged your mom's wishes. She gave you two small taps on the crown of your head. You're the last one down today. You know that? Life isn't a race. If it was, I don't need to win. I was going to stay in longer, so you're welcome. Oh, that's me. I was like, I could have slept in through the whole day, but I decided to grace you with my presence. Yes, thank you for gracing us all with your presence this fine day. Oh, the dog's barking. Oh, my package is here. My packages are here. Okay, one sec. Let me go bring them inside. I'll be right back. Where am I? Where my OBS go? All right, BRB. Y'all behave in there. Okay, I'm back. I was gonna make BB warm up. Oh, you know, I thought about it. I should be add the TTS into the BRB screen so y'all can make him say whatever while I'm not here. Oh my gosh. I'm still out of breath. I was running. I was ready for these packages. One of them was my HelloFresh box. Get my little meals. And the other one is a little Nendoroid. I know it's Hatsune Miku, but I don't know which one it is. I'm assuming it's the one of the ones they had up on the... Was it? There was some kind of sale going on.
It's okay. I'm a patient bear. Do re mi the sol la ti do.
Very nice, BB. Very nice. Gosh, BB getting into his singing art. Fucking autocorrect. It's okay. It's close enough. Ouch. I'm opening it. Yeah, one sec, guys. I need to unbox this to cure my curiosity. Which one is it? Oh, okay, it's one of the... It's the Snow Miku one that I bought. Yes, yes. Very nice. I've been keeping my eye on this one for years, but it's like it goes for like $100 on like the pre-owned websites. I was like, I ain't paying that much, so I paid $70 for this one. It's just as good, right? So let me see. Let me bring up a picture. Snow Miku, and then we'll get back into the game. Just one sec. Thank you guys for your patience. I need to show. Oh, here it is. Immediate, really. Right there. Save image on desktop. Miku. Ah, bitch. Type it in. Miku. No, it's a web file. Can I still open that in here? I want to get so many Miku figures, right? Me too. I want to have a whole shelf of just Miku figures in my room. I have two now. I have a scale figure and then this one. And then I have one ordered that I think is supposed to be coming like in the next few months or so. Because I think it's coming from Japan and I use like the cheapest shipping. They are so pretty. They are. I love them so much. Where? Miku? There she is. Okay, this is the one I got. Right here. Hatsune Miku. Oh my gosh, Miku, I didn't know you were in the game. Oh my gosh, she's here. She's here at the door. She's visiting us. Let's see, what year is this one? Oh, you're gonna make me sign back in to this place? Ah. Please tell me this is my password. Nope, it's not. Oh well. Let's see, does this tell me the year? I found out the shelf of bit on my desk isn't the best place to hold figures. Oh no, did it collapse? Has it fallen? I cannot see when this came out. Oh well. But it is so cute. The shelf though is a little slanted, it seems. Oh, so it kind of just slides off. Yeah. That's not very good. Oh shit, one of the arms fell off. One of the things. I'm sure it's all good. But yes, I got this one. My Mieto figure fell and gave me a scare. Oh, is it okay? I'm assuming it didn't break, but oh my gosh. That would terrify me. There we go. Delete that. And I'm waiting for the new Snow Miku to come in. And I can display them with my other Miku figure. It'll be great. I still need to build my Detolf. He's okay? Okay, good. We don't want him to die a second time. But okay. With our little distraction out of the way, we can proceed. The type of figure I got is pretty good, so I'm not worried. Yeah. We're glad he survived. Please. Thank you for gracing us all with your presence this fine day. With a small laugh, Mon stepped aside. Ko was just as you remembered. Exactly how you came to know him to be. Oh, there he is! He leaned uncomfortably to the side in your doorway as his bushy hair covered part of his face. His features were pinched in embarrassment, and he shifted from one foot to another. He was holding what must be the much-talked-about gift. I just need to get the wall shelves. Mm-hmm. Make it more secure. At first glance, you figured it must be the bouquet of flowers, then you gave it a real look. No, instead it was carefully cut fruit. It made a lot of sense that it was actually from Cove's dad. You had to suppress a laugh at this showing. You could imagine many folks buying that sort of thing off for their own personal enjoyment. You got fruit flowers. That kind of arrangement was built for the presentation, likely to impress whoever was inevitably going to receive it. You see, no matter how long he lived here, Mr. Holden would keep going out of his way to be neighborly, and Cove would always be roped into participating. At the sight of you, Cove smiled, but there was some nervousness to it. Hey. You smiled back. You couldn't help thinking to when you first met Cove and how you became such good friends. Lately, though, you were starting to have different feelings for him. Hey, it's nice to see you. Yeah. You too. His grip on the base of the gift tightened and your heartbeat sped up. Even if neither of you had spoken about it, both of you were aware something new was growing in your relationship. It was already shaping up to be another long summer. The best part was that the two of you had plenty of time to spend together and explore what was developing. His awkwardness over the task started to creep back in, so Cove nudged the gift closer to you. He was ready to be relieved of it. Your hands brushed over his just slightly when you took hold of the base. He flinched enough for you to know with certainty that he noticed it happen. You couldn't help but smile to yourself. And with that, the gift was accepted. I hope you and your family like this. It's a pretty good gift. I think so, anyway. He smiled earnestly. Dad spent a lot of time picking out the best size and design. There were so many options to choose from. You're too cute sometimes. No, I am not like that. Thank you. Could you tell your dad we loved the gift? Yeah. Mr. Holden's behavior really was different from any neighbor you'd ever had, though after 5 years you were used to his antics, and you'd since made up your mind on what your opinion was. Oh. So, what's our opinion of Mr. Holden? He was nice, he was sort of funny, he was pretty weird. You didn't like him. He was great. And kinda handsome to boot. He's so tall now. He barely fit in the frame, I know. I mean, he's the tallest in the class, apparently. Hatred. Damn. Jack. We all know Jack's feelings on Mr. Holden. There we go. He's sus. He's pretty weird. You couldn't imagine having to live with him all the time like Cove did. Your thoughts were quickly interrupted by a shout. There you are! You shared a confused look with Cove. As one, both of you stepped through the open door to onto the neighborhood street. Alright, y'all ready to meet the other boy? It didn't take long to locate the source of the noise. You spotted Derek just a few yards down the road. He ran up to you. You were happy at the sight of him. Derek was certainly a welcome guest in your neighborhood. It was a pleasant surprise whenever he showed up. And there he is, the boy. After stopping a couple steps away, Derek hunched over to catch his breath. Then he looked up with a wide grin. Hey. Hey, guy and pal. I was just at your house, Cove, but no one was there. Should have figured you'd be at Dae's place. Do you ever spend time in your own home, or are you always just there? Derek laughed at his own joke. He either didn't notice that it embarrassed Cove, or the embarrassment was what he was actually laughing at. Derek turned to you. He was going to say more, when his eyes widened and he gasped. What's that? You followed his gaze, unsure. Then you realized what he meant. You were still holding Mr. Holden's gift. This is kind of like a bouquet of flowers, but made of fruit. Nice. Can I have some? We can share. I haven't tried any yet. It's a gift from my family. I can't give it to you. Maybe you can have some later. He's so small. He is small. He's so tiny. For now. But yeah, I haven't even tried any yet. Derek pouted at your words, not hiding his disappointment. Aw. Then he nodded his head, as if to clear it. Anyways, that's right. I came here because I needed to say something big. He paused, possibly for effect. There's some other kid here in Sunset Bird. Cove was as surprised as you were by the news. Such a reaction made no sense. No one around your age had moved here since Cove did 5 years ago. For now? Yeah, I said what I said. Were they with their family? Maybe they were just cutting through. Nuh-uh. The new kid was all by himself, just walking. Did you talk to him? Nope. I came to report the sighting right away. The kid had green hair, glasses, was pretty small, and seemed really upset about something. I hope he didn't leave. You blinked. Slowly, you looked over to your longtime neighbor. That sounds a lot like you, Cove. When you first got here, anyway. It kinda does, doesn't it? That's weird. He sounded almost fond, a small smile playing on his lips. Derek snickered good-naturedly. Oh. I can see that really well, now that you say so. But what do you say? Let's go find Cove's lookalike. We should all meet him. I'll do it. Sure. I want to see who this person is. Derek grinned, then he pointed down the street, the way he came. Last I saw him, the mystery visitor was going this direction. Nothing else needed to be said. The three of you were off, with Derek leading the way. Derek brought you to the beach, and as a true, you made your way down the shore to the old playground. You walked the familiar path in comfortable silence. When you were almost there, you spotted the kid in question. His bright colors almost shone like a beacon beneath the rays of the sun. Oh my gosh, y'all are gonna love this new character too. He scuffled around, kicking up the sand as he paced. It was true. He certainly seemed upset, but you didn't think he was sad, like you had originally pictured. No, with his erratic movements and scrunched up expression, he came off angry. You started to have doubts about this expedition. Maybe it'd be better if you'd left him alone and let him sort himself out. Derek didn't feel the same. He waved wildly, calling out to the boy. Oh, Derek, read the room. Hey, guy, over here. The kid whipped around, an impressive scowl covering deeper into his face. His eyes were tired, but a strong, hostile energy still radiated from him. Angy boy. What? What is it? What do you want? A sharp tone made Derek flinch. He shifted on his feet. What's your name? Jeremy. Was that it? No. I'm Derek. That's Dae and Cove. We were just walking around and saw you. We wanted to say hi. There aren't a lot of kids our age in this neighborhood. Yeah, so you know, it's cool to see someone else here. Strangely, Jeremy grew furious by your response. If steam could have ripped from a person's ears, it would have happened then. They did bring me somewhere stupid. Of course. I knew it. What? My parents. They're the ones who brought me. I didn't walk to this town. Can you not figure that out on your own? My dad brings me to Sunset Bird too, when he has to come for work and all that stuff. That's not bad. That earned him a glare from Jeremy. Derek winced beneath it, glancing away. It was a struggle to remain friendly with this Jeremy guy. I mean, I wouldn't want to come here for a real vacation probably either. That's an understatement. This doesn't count as a vacation. It's a waste of time. A chore. My parents' family's nearby, and we just had to come to see them. Ugh! If they're your parents' family, doesn't that make them your family too? That's a pretty good reason to come by. Did you want to go somewhere else? No. Jeremy crossed his arms with a huff. He turned away. They should have gone by themselves since they cared so much and left me home, but I'm not allowed to be by myself. Pfft. It makes no sense. They're the ones who don't know how to do anything, and I'm the kid? You kept quiet. You shouldn't talk about your parents like that. Sorry, it must suck being forced to do something you don't want. We just said hello. You don't have to keep complaining at us. Calm down, you don't have to yell so much. Who peed in your cereal this morning? Who the fuck pissed in your Cheerios, kid? Just so much anger. Let's see. Let me go ahead and save. Where am I? Here I am. Oh, I'm gonna have to remember to not override this save here. So let me remember. 4 and the third one over. Okay. Because that's what we'll need to do to get into Derek's route later. Later down the line. Who peed in your cereal this morning? I'm just gonna go right for it. Jeremy's lips curled as his face contorted from anger to horror. How would you think of something like that? It's disgusting. Sheesh. It's just an expression. He took a deep breath. He thought for one hopeful second that maybe he was calming himself down. He was not. So what? You're putting it in people's heads. I don't want to have to think about it. And someone brainless might decide it's a good idea and actually do it. There are some real stupids out in the world, you know? You're all living proof of that. Hey, we're not stupid. I'm smarter than you are, probably. How are you going to prove that when you're just saying one more moronic thing after another? You turn to Cove, lowering your voice. The two of you aren't that similar after all. Jeremy must have had good hearing, though, because he caught in the private exchange and scoffed. Of course we're not similar. My eyebrows aren't stupid. Not his wavy eyebrows! Cove's cheeks flushed and crimson at the insult. You couldn't be sure if it was out of embarrassment or anger. Maybe both. Come on. What? No, Cove's wavy eyebrows are so cool. How can you say that when you've got a bowl cut? You have no right to speak about someone's appearance. Don't listen to him. They're really unique and special. Well, they are kind of silly. Oh my gosh, just going after Cove. Apologize to Cove right now. You can't treat people like that. Cove smiled weakly. Okay, I'm sorry your eyebrows are so terrible. You just rolled your eyes, you crossed your arms over your chest, you shook your head, you patted Cove on the shoulder. You lunged towards Jeremy. Go for the jugular! Fight, fight, fight! With your fist balled, you made a quick step forward. He was the one who started things. You were ready to end them. Oh my god. Alright, we spook him. He made it clear that words wouldn't work, leaving you to resort to action, even if it was just for show. Oh, come on, guys. Derek and Cove jumped in to stop you before you reached him. They each grabbed you by the arm. Still, Jeremy instinctively stumbled backwards. He practically fell over. Ha, bitch. If that's all you can do about what I'm saying, it's just proving I'm right. You're brainless. Jeremy continued to defensively fume and throw out insults. The reaction you got was definitely worth any consequences. Wow, what is wrong with you? Instead of taking an offense, Jeremy only parroted Derek's words in her nasally voice.
Wow, what is wrong with you?
Wah-wah. This is dumb. Jeremy stuck out his tongue and skulked away, throwing more sand everywhere as he went. You watched him go, hunched over, until he became a speck in your vision. Silence reigned in his wake. The three of you tried to process what just happened. I can't believe it. What a mean kid. Derek wasn't kidding, and by the sound of those earlier complaints, the new boy Jeremy was going to be in the area for at least a little while this summer. Derek sighed in dismay, popping onto the ground. You followed, and Cove did too shortly after. There wasn't much else to do.
Sucks.
I was hoping we could meet someone fun, hang out maybe. He shook his head. After a moment, he slowly turned to you with a hopeful expression. But, you know what would really improve this day? Did we win? I mean, for now. Technically. We scared him off, it's all good. Huh? He didn't respond. Instead, he used a hand to point right at the fruit arrangement that you were still holding. You'd completely forgotten about it during the mini drama that unfolded. You had gotten used to the weight. Glancing over to Cove, you noticed he was eyeing the fruit. He must want some too. Alright, let's eat. For our victory, it's a reward. It's like a reward. Derek perked up immediately at your words. He reached out for a skewer, hesitating slightly once he was inches away.
Sure?
Yeah, I'm sure. You nodded. With an eager grin, he plucked out a prime row of fruits. Cove grabbed for one himself after him. Only you were without a skewer of your own. Pineapple. The pineapple was cut to look like a flower. It was the obvious first choice. Derek ate a pineapple skewer enthusiastically, finishing it within moments. Mmm, this is amazing.
Nice.
It tastes pretty nice, and this fruit kebab thing is fun. Hey, you two remember the land before time? The fruit thing makes me think of it. The dinosaurs are like the leaves that were shaped like stars. Tree stars.
Yeah,
chomping leaves looked so delicious when they did it. And there was that scene with the pretty trees, and all the dinosaurs came in and picked everything off them till there was nothing. That's us right now. Awesome. I love that movie. I've never seen it. I didn't like that one. That movie's for kids. What are you, a baby? Eating leaves looks good? Should I worry about you? Do you think things take better when they're shaped like stars? Oh my gosh, hell yeah. He snickered. Not everything, but it probably helps. The three of you continued like this for the next few minutes. Eventually, the display was barren. It looked weird when devoid of fruit. Hey, we weren't supposed to eat all of it.
Oopsie daisies.
Really? You couldn't stop yourself from sighing at the boys. You just wanted to eat some and have a nice time. Now you're probably going to get in trouble. You could only accept it, though. Hey, Dae. Yeah? The two of you met eyes casually. Were you seriously going to hit that guy? No, I just knew he'd get all scared over it. Phew, that was pretty bad, Dae. I thought it was cool. Ooh! The Cove is into bad boys. You're both crazy people. And Derek's more of a little pacifist. No fighting! And Cove's like, fight, fight, fight. You know when Derek said things like that, it wasn't serious. He liked you and Cove. Yeah. Derek then leaned back on his arms. He contemplated the sky with a content sigh. So, are you both ready for summer break? Hell yeah. Cool on you. Wish I could say the same. It feels like there's a lot to plan for. And what about you, Cove? Are you ready? Yeah. Before you could say anything else, the light atmosphere was shattered.
Hey.
Dae! You glanced over your shoulder to see your sister. She strode closer and closer, appearing none too pleased. I've been looking all over for you. Ma said you and Cove ran off with the thing Mr. Holden bought for us. She leered over you with arms folded. So? Where is it? Well, funny thing, it's gone. What do you mean gone? He into that. He do be into it. He's into violence. Moved over to the side to face her completely. She zeroed in on the bouquet in your hands, which was now populated exclusively with skewers dripping in juice and tiny flecks of leftover fruit pieces. Her mouth dropped open and the tone of her voice rose. Seriously, Dae? What were you thinking? It was supposed to be for all of us at home. She glanced at Cove, who sat beside you, and continued mockingly. Even if you are the most important person in the household to the delivery boy, this was up to his dad. It seemed everybody was in a mood to tease you and Cove today. The moment Cove's cheeks flushed red, he picked up the hem of his shirt, suddenly finding it very interesting. He always became nervous when Elizabeth would strike at your relationship. Sorry, Elizabeth. Get over it. Well, this morning's been kind of a disaster. We were hungry? It wasn't us. A seagull came down and ate it while we weren't looking. I mean, listen. I've seen the videos. Seagulls can be pretty brutal whenever food's involved. Elizabeth narrowed her eyes, not at all deceived by your response. Oh no, I think I hear the mean kid coming back. We better get out of here. Elizabeth blinked, confused, and looked around. What kid? I don't see anyone. Derek didn't bother explaining. He just launched to his feet and ran off. Cove hopped up too, gladly taking the opportunity to exit this situation. He followed after Derek, but he sent a look to you from over his shoulder. You turned to watch Elizabeth. She stared back, brow raised. Got a blast! Without a word, you two got to your feet and bolted down the beach. Unimpressed, Elizabeth rolled her eyes. I like to think I'm very mature, actually. She shook her head as she walked towards the house, not bothering whatsoever to follow. Meanwhile, the three of you made it back to the shoreline. Derek pumped his fist, grinning in triumph. We escaped and shall live to see another day. Yeah, for now at least. Mom's gonna be so mad when Elizabeth tells the story. Yes, we live for now. I still have to face Elizabeth when I go back home. You chuckled together, walking further down the beach side by side. You definitely wanted to stay outside a little while longer. You'd gotten a bit of a scolding from your moms for not saving any of Mr. Horn's gift for Elizabeth, but you didn't get any real punishment for it. Instead, while you were out with the boys, Elizabeth returned home to share the news. The three of them went to get dessert on their own. It was cleared even by your parents when everyone got back and the event was settled. Just rubbing it in our faces. Well, since you got to eat all the fruit skewers, we went out and got dessert. So I hope that is alright with you. After that, Derek had rejoined you in the living room. He elected to stay outside for extra time so that you could face the potential scolding from your family without him witnessing the embarrassment. Derek was a guy you could count on. The dust had settled from the prior events and your moms went back to their room, so Derek was just taking it easy until his dad arrived. Mr. Suarez was meant to be there any minute to get Derek. Is this new? As in, I don't think I remember this when it was just Cove's route. Derek preferred not to sit and instead took long, lazy strides in a circle around the edge of the road. Yeah, I think this. I don't think I've seen this before. Oh my gosh, new content. For me. Hands behind his back and head angled towards the ceiling, Derek looked like he might have been puzzling out a crime. Ooh. What crimes are on your mind, Derek? You probably made half a dozen rounds when a solid knock struck your front door. That stopped Derek in his tracks. Dad's here. Both of you stepped towards the door in unison. You arrived first, since you had half a room head start. When you pulled it open only a crack, someone zoomed in past you. Oh, it is new. We get to meet when it was just Kojo, we didn't get to meet his brothers. The breakneck flash of a human was still entirely recognizable. It was Derek's little brother, Nicholas Suarez. He shouted triumphantly. Derek, we're here! He was only six, the tiniest kid around. Hot on his heels came in the middle Sora's son, George. We have to stay in the car. We're going home. We're not here to play. He was 10, and his patience was being tested. The youngest one frantically shook his head. It made his hair even messier than it already was. Nicholas's hair was as wild and as free as he was. Hair clips in his parents' minivan couldn't contain the energy. Which might have been surprising considering he loved cars enough to wear a shirt covered in them, but you knew Nicholas loved Derek even more. Staying right where he was, inside your house, at his even older brother's side, Nicholas gave Derek a hug. I came to get you. Derek bent down to scoop Nicholas into his arms in a fond squeeze, though he kept his face tilted up to make eye contact with George. Hey bros. Side by side, Mr. and Mrs. Soros trailed in. Oh my gosh, we're meeting the whole family. This is great. Mr. Soros got that stance like the... What's the stance called? Like, you know how to do it to him? Like, the guy wearing, like, the button-up shirt and the shorts with sandals standing on the sidewalk. The resemblance between the parents and their children was clear. Derek and George were the spitting image of their father. George was even sometimes called Junior, while Nicholas was a mommy's boy. Good evening, Dae. Hello. You'll have to forgive the three-ring circus for Zingtown. The boys had just had to come. Dae pretty. They are pretty. Why are all the parents in this game so pretty? Hi, don't worry about that. You're welcome here. You didn't know what to say to them. I'm just so... The bear remained speechless at the sight of the pretty parents. I love seeing the boys. You merely shrugged. Don't worry about it. You're welcome here. The frown that had been stuck on George's face finally eased up a little. Oh, how kind. Bye. But we can't stay. Thank you for letting Derek visit and tell your mothers I said hello. Okay. Come on, boys. All four of you now. Let's give the Ursa family their house back. Coming. Yep. Half of the group trotted forward with only a word. They went past Mrs. Suarez and out the door. She watched them go before surveying the situation with the most troublesome one. Nicholas was just bouncing around Derek as if he hadn't even heard his parent. Derek and his mom looked on with identical expressions of exhaustion, tinged affection. An opportunity opened up between hops. Derek carefully took hold of Nicholas's small hand. Let's go to the car, Nico. You can sit next to me. Thrilled by the promise, Nicholas let out another cheer. Let's go to the car. Mrs. Suarez left it there, trusting her eldest, and went to join Mr. Suarez and George. Nicholas gripped Derek's black wristband with his free hand, stretching it outwards in his eager attempt to lead his bigger brother along. Derek stumbled forward with a chuckle, mostly to protect his band from being pulled too far rather than Nicholas actually having the strength to move him. But he made sure not to forget you. Derek said his goodbye from over his shoulder. Bye, pal. Bye. Good night. Goodbye, everybody. And good night. After their prompt entrance and equally quick exit, the whole Suarez family was on their way home. You, however, didn't have anywhere to go. It was late enough that the rest of the day would be spent inside your own house. That was a while ago now. Later that night, you found yourself seated near the kitchen counter. Oh yes, we're going to meet the next new character. There's so many new characters. Oh my gosh, with the introduction of Derek's family in this step, we're meeting like a whole, like a shit ton of new characters in this step. There's so many. Like, I was trying to think of like how many there were before. And like, I think before Derek's DLC was released, there was like 4 new characters introduced. And now with his whole family, it's 8. We love more characters. Your fingers drummed on the surface as you waited, your gaze trained on the phone. You were waiting on a call tonight, specifically from your cousin, Leandra. You didn't want to miss it accidentally. Your uncle, aunt, and Lee used to live many hours away. Your families only saw each other a few times a year for big occasions. A while back, though, they moved and were closer to you than ever before. You now hung out regularly. With school being out, you're positive she's going to want to come over a lot. The two of you were the same age and got along well. She used to be really fond of Lizzie, Elizabeth, too. But now that your sister had become allergic to interacting with her own family, it tended to be just you and Lee who spent time together. She was your only friend who was a girl. Being family helped make you close, but you had a lot of girlfriends. I'd say I have a couple of girlfriends. Even though you weren't a girl, you befriended them pretty well. You also had a lot of non-girlfriends? Yeah. It doesn't matter the gender. Gender? I make friends with everybody. What kind of gender someone who didn't seem to make any difference in who you got along with? Then the shrill ringtone announced an incoming call. You jumped before grabbing the receiver and pressing it to your ear. Who is it? Your worst nightmare. Of course you knew right away who it was. You laughed. Hi, Lee. Dropping the joke, she laughed too. Hi, Dae. There was static on the end, as if Lee was shifting wherever she was. So, can you believe that school's actually over? I thought it'd never be done. Now we don't have to do any of that boring stuff, and we get to hang out whenever we want. Speaking of hanging out... Lee, can you wait a second? Let me just head to my room. Oh, yeah. You got up from your seat on the counter. Luckily, the phone was wireless, so you didn't have to worry about any cords tying you down. Your mom's had a rule about not moving the phone unless the call was in progress, which was why you'd been sat by its cradle waiting for Lee to call. Oh my gosh, we're so nice. So unfair. Wow. You thought that made sense. It was nice to keep everything in its proper place. But now that Lee had called, it was okay for you to go upstairs to your bedroom and talk to her. You made your way to the stairs, smiling. After you had arrived, you shut the bedroom door firmly behind you. You took a seat on your bed. Alright, I'm here. Cool. Hey, did you know? The girl down the street from me has her own phone now. A cell phone. She didn't have to wait for someone else to stop using it or anything. Wow, really? The thought of someone having a phone that was all their own seemed unbelievable to you. And now these days, toddlers have their own phones too. It's kind of crazy. Right? I wish I had one too. My parents said I couldn't get my own phone until I'm more grown up. I wish they'd change their mind. We could call each other every single day and no one would be able to stop us. How great would that be? Oh my gosh, I can't mentally prepare for phone calls every day though, Lee. God damn. But wouldn't I still be using the home phone? My moms would be able to stop us if they wanted. Lee laughed. You didn't put a damper on her imagination. Oh, then you have your own phone too. That works. She sighed dramatically. I bet I'm not going to get one until I'm all the way in college. Squeezing the phone between your shoulder and ear, you puffed up your pillows and made yourself more comfy. It was strange to think of a time when normal school would be over and you'd have to choose whether or not to go to a college. School is such a big part of your life right now. Studying didn't come easy to you, though you tried hard, you worked about as hard as most people, and got pretty average results as well. You never tried much, but you still didn't do that bad. You didn't bother at all in school, and your grades reflected that. Even though your class came easily to you, you worked hard for your excellent grades. I think... Now, I'll be honest. In school, I didn't really try that hard. I didn't really care that much, but I also didn't really do too bad as well. I think I kind of, like, understood things pretty decently. I definitely could have tried harder. But I never really, like, had any risk of failing classes or anything, but, you know. Coasting by had become routine for you. Teachers had warned you that you wouldn't be able to do that forever, but you figured it was enough for now. You felt a lot of pressure to get higher grades than you did last year. You hoped to do just as well this year, but it wouldn't be a big deal if they dropped some. You're confident your grades would remain great. You had no plans on getting excellent scores this time around. Yeah, we always hope to do well, but it's okay if things don't go as you hoped they would be. Grades weren't the most important thing, no matter how good or bad they ended up being. Yeah. You tried to sound engaged, but your mind had decided to go back to school despite the season. Lee knew you too well to be fooled. You sound so spacey. What's up? Just thinking about school. Lee groaned. Are you thinking about how much we don't have to think about it because it's summer? That's what I'm doing. Let's make a petition for more vacation time. It's awful. I hate going. Come on, it's too scary not to think about it. Let's make a petition. Everybody in class would sign it. Maybe some of the teachers, too. Though I guess school isn't all the way bad. You can do some good things there. You can just do more when school's out. Learning new things is always cool. I just wish everyone did okay with how they taught the things, not just some people. Gym is pretty great. I would never say that, but yeah. There are all sorts of sports stuff during gym. Oh yeah, it can be fun sometimes. It's the easiest way to hang out with people not in the neighborhood, that's true. If I didn't go to school, I'd never meet anybody new. No one really comes here. Mm-hmm. The cafeteria lunches at my school could be better than they had any right to be. Lucky. Mine's boring. But that was all. That's it. And that's pretty much everything that's good about school. Okay, point taken. Now I decree the topic of school is officially closed. We have to talk about this summer first before we start plotting the rest of our lives. I got some plans already. Ooh, tell me. I'm gonna visit my cousins. He chuckled, of course. What's something you want to do? The first thing that comes to your head. Get some new art supplies, spend time with people reading, catch up with all movies and TV. Probably I'll spend time at the beach. I don't want to do anything at all. It's vacation. I just want to sit down and vegetate. I'll probably go to the beach. I could have guessed that one. Oh, well, you asked. You lean back in your bed, settling in. As you continue chatting with your friend, even though it hadn't been that long since you saw her and you'd be seeing her soon, you found plenty to talk about. For one of the events of the day, you sat up straighter. I was with Cove and Derek today, and we met a new kid. Like, at your neighborhood? Mm-hmm. His parents are visiting family, so it seems like he'll be around for a little while. I don't know how long. What was he like? Mean. He kept snapping when all we were trying to do was talk to him. He just kept being rude to everyone. But especially Cove. It was awful. I don't think I want to meet him. You want a boy to stay away before even meeting him? That's an unexpected twist. Your cousin was pretty popular with the boys who knew her. She seemed happy enough to have them around until they started to annoy her. Hey, who are you to talk? You give practically all your attention to boys. Maybe just one boy. I see how much you like Cove. Lee, you shut the fuck up right now. It's an exception. It's a special case. We've been friends since we were children. It just comes naturally. Lee laughed at your defensiveness, deeply amused. Even though she couldn't see, you shook your head at her, grinning to yourself. Oop. There was a stomping noise approaching your room, heralding the arrival of your irritated older sister. She flung the door open, a frown etched on her face. How long are you going to hog the phone? Glancing at your watch, you realized that your quick call had gone on much longer than anticipated. Elizabeth held out her hand, the other one lodged on her hip. She noticed the realization on your face. Time's up. But I'm still using it. Not anymore. You don't get everything in the world. And neither do you. I'm not the one asking for it. You had your turn. Now you want to get mine too because you were first? In your dreams, I will get Mom's. Fine. Lee, I have to go now. Okay, see you soon. Tell Elizabeth and your moms I said hi too. You barely pressed the end call button when Elizabeth whisked the handset from your fingers and began dialing someone new as she strode out of the room. Your mom's voice called down from downstairs. Hey, has anyone seen the phone? I'm using it. With that, she shut your door behind you. Silence was left in the wake. That was one way to end your first day of summer break. Sometime later, it had gotten dark outside, and you laid in bed wide awake. Your window rattled all of a sudden, startling you badly. You flinched, staring over at it with furrowed brows. From your vantage point, you saw only the moon and open sky. You were... confused. What had caused that noise? Frowning, you sat up and moved closer to the window. You might as well find the reason behind the disturbance. To your utter shock, your gaze had was met by a pair of familiar ocean blue eyes. Cove? You squinted. Yep, Cove was right outside your window. Your house was very angular, and some parts stuck out further than others, so it theoretically wouldn't be hard to climb around on. So just because somebody could, didn't mean you expected it to ever happen. Cove looked awkward and unstable. His feet were braced against a section of the wall that jutted out, his arms flexing with effort to keep him upright. I smack on the window. He falls down. With difficulty, he waved. Then he wobbled, immediately dropping his hand in alarm. You hurriedly opened the window. Cove scrambled inside, nearly falling flat on his face, but he was able to do right himself in the end. He released a breath once he was steady. Hi, Dae. What's up, Romeo?
Oh, Romeo, Romeo, where art thou, Romeo?
I'm outside your window, bitch. Amazing, my dreams have come true. Oh my gosh, well, you know, I know it's late, but I didn't know what else to do. If I rang the doorbell, I know your moms would have answered. They'd just make me go home. I didn't really want to explain why I was coming over anyway. I don't want to talk about it. Well, besides with you, I mean. But that's why I did that. Like a bug. About that at the window. As unexpected as this was, your touched Ko felt like he could tell you what was wrong. I might have tried calling or something, except my dad was on the phone. Cove suddenly looked very cross. Dad, he was talking to my mom. Still is, apparently. Probably. You raised your eyebrows. Cove had eavesdropped on his parents' phone conversation.
Yeah, you shouldn't have done that. Eavesdropping is bad.
No comment. You do you. There are other things to talk about. Are you going to stay with your mom for a while again? Every year, Cove was sent off to live with his mom for a few weeks. When it would happen varied. Sometimes he would go during winter break, but usually he went during summer. Even though it was hard news when you found out he was leaving and you missed seeing him those weeks, you understood. To your surprise, however, he shook his head. That's what I thought too, but no, that's not what they were saying. My dad asked my mom not to have me leave this year. He said she could come stay with us here. You waited for him to continue. He didn't. The conversation abruptly dropped off. You couldn't help but stare at Ko. There was a complicated mix of expressions on his face. What did your mom say? She told him she'd come. I know she's coming soon, before school starts. Oh. You had heard Ko talk about his mom a lot over the years. He'd tell you about past memories or what happened while he was visiting her. So it was one thing to hear about someone and another to actually meet them. Very soon you were going to see Ko's mom in person. You were taken aback by the news, so you could only imagine how Ko felt. You looked over at him. He was pacing across your room. His features pained with dread. Before they'd barely stay in the same room long enough to have lunch. Now we're gonna all be together again, the three of us. After all this time? Just for a few weeks. I know you should probably be happy they can talk to each other. I'm still not. I'm just confused and freaked out. Now I feel really bad for feeling this way. Dae, it's so... His fist tightened and his eyes became misty. Oh, he's crying. I shouldn't keep getting like this. It's been a long time already and I'm not a little kid. Though he wouldn't meet your eyes, you knew he was waiting for you to say something. There's nothing wrong with feeling bad. That is hard to deal with. We can deal with this. I'm sorry, Cove. You know I'm here for you. Yeah, that's... a lot. I mean, your emotions are valid. The tense line of Cove's shoulders eased. Thanks. That makes me feel a little better. Like I'm not freaking out for no reason. A momentary silence fell over the two of you. You marveled at how the Dae started. You had woken up eager for summer vacation, but now things seem so crazy. The mini debacle with Mr. Holden's gift, the newest addition to the neighborhood being so rude. And as if all of that wasn't enough, now Cove's mom would be living with Cove and his dad again. Give him a hug. We will. Your whole life was kind of like that, it seemed. Complicated and hard and different. Why couldn't things just get better with time? Dae? The sound of your name said quietly, pulled you from your thoughts. Cove gazed at you concerned. Yeah, I'm okay. You meant it. Yeah, I'm okay. You didn't mean it. No, I'm not. I don't know. Who, me? I'm worried about you. Wow, things are kind of bad for everyone. I mean, it's about you, dude. You don't have to forget about yourself for me. I want to listen to you, too. Ko grinned reassuringly. It was small and delicate, but you knew it was genuine. Moonlight from outside cast shadows across his face and lit up his eyes. They seemed to sparkle with his smile. Just that one look brightened your mood somewhat. You know, I think I don't want to talk any more about this. He looked away, his lips thinning into a line, and rubbed at his arms. But I kind of don't want to go back home either. Could I stay a little longer, just doing something else? You appeared equal parts hopeful and vulnerable. How could you possibly turn him away? Get out. Back out the window, bitch. No. Let's see. You could say tonight, but we shouldn't make a habit of this. I've got a flashlight and some cards. Are you in? Oh, hell yeah. Let's play war. You tilted your head, waiting patiently for his answer. Ko perked up at your response, a smile appearing on his face. He immediately took a seat on your bed, not afraid to get comfortable in your room. You felt a little better at the sight somehow. You still had a lot of worries, but you were glad he was there. And not just tonight. You were glad he came into your life in the first place. That was a change you'd never want to undo. It felt totally unnatural to let him into your little world. That initial friendship that deepened so much over these past years, and you were certain there was room to get even closer. Oop. Oh my gosh, we're getting real close. You joined Cove on your bed, taking a seat across from him. He smiled at you again, but you could tell this time it was half-hearted. He was still easy to read. Though he didn't want to talk about his mom and dad, he must be thinking about what happened and what's about to happen. Let's see. There it is. You hugged him. You moved closer and wrapped your arms around him. It wasn't much, but you hoped the contact helped even a little. Ko froze up, startled. After a moment, his arms came up and he returned your hug. The two of you remained like that for some time. He might have mumbled something to you, but it was too quiet to tell what it was. When you pulled back, his expression had softened into something more natural. Conversation was stilted and broken, often by silence at first. Then both of you were able to get back into your usual candor. As your secret hangout session stretched on, you thought that you truly wanted to keep having moments like this with him. You hoped a day would never come when life decided that the two of you would have to part ways, and you knew Ko felt the same. Hell yeah, secret hangout sessions at night. You opened your tired eyes, groaning as they adjusted to the bright light that was streaming through your window and warming your peachy skin. With a loud yawn, you rolled away from the sunlight and blinked a couple of times, clearing the sleep from your eyes before realizing with a start that it was actually morning. You couldn't remember even falling asleep. Cove had crept through your window during the night, and the two of you spent time together, trying not to wake your parents. You must have fallen asleep while you were hanging out, but couldn't put a finger on exactly when. You wondered how late Cove had stayed before heading home. You rubbed your face and yawned again, contemplating whether you should get out of bed and get ready for the day, or stay snuggled up for a little while longer. Until your gaze landed on an instantly recognizable mop of pale green hair, and you bolted upright and gasped in surprise. He never left! He was still there! In the morning! Bet you gotta get out, Cove! He had fallen asleep while sitting on the ground and precariously leaning his head on the side of your mattress. Oh my gosh, the neck pain he's gonna get when he wakes up. With your shout, Cove's eyes snapped open and his head slipped from his source of support. He didn't stop going out until he smacked right into the floor with a crack. You clipped a hand over your mouth and looked down at him with wide eyes, curled up where he had landed rather ungracefully. Ow. Oopsies. Are you okay? You winced at his tumble, hoping no one else in the house had heard either of your outbursts. Yeah, I'm alright. Cove rubbed his forehead a little. You weren't sure that was entirely true. If either of your moms found out Cove had slept there here last night, the two of you would be in big trouble. Cove blinked at you a couple of times, his eyes growing in panic as some thought that only he could hear settled in his mind. I fell asleep! You weren't exactly sure what to do as you watched Cove pace your room, looking around frantically. Cove's hands flew to his face, letting out a sigh of relief when he found his glasses right where they were supposed to be. At least I found my glasses, though. Despite that, he hadn't calmed down completely. The atmosphere was still frazzled. It's gonna be alright. We're gonna get in so much trouble. Just calm down, settle down before mom sees you. It's gonna be alright. Let's just calm down and think of a plan. We just need to leave before anyone notices you're here. If they knew, we would have heard about it already. Cove nodded, his shoulders tense as he fixed you with a firm stare with his turquoise eyes. Letting out a heavy sigh, he ran a hand through his hair in exasperation. He couldn't look at you again as he spoke. I'll see you later. You're confused by how all of this had played out, but hoped that was true. Right. Bye, Cove. At that, you were suddenly wrapped in a tense embrace. As panicked as he was, it seemed to be something he couldn't forget before leaving. Thanks, again. Gotta give a quick hug to the homies before you jump out the window. You're my very best friend, Dae. No one else comes close. He firmly whispered the words in the top of your shoulder. It made you feel tingly. But you were let go before you had a chance to respond, or even fully react. In a matter of seconds, he had climbed over your bed and opened this window. A cool breeze rolled off the ocean, fluttering through Cove's hair and filling your room with its salty scent. Cove anxiously stepped out onto the ledge. You wished him luck, you rallied him to keep going, you suggested he sneak out the door instead, you urged him to hurry up. Hurry up, bitch! Good luck! Be super careful. You weren't sure if he had heard you or not, but he kept going along, one foot in front of the other, with increasing speed until his form disappeared out of sight. You stuck your head out the window as far as it could go to try to keep him watch. He walked with the full length of the ledge before jumping down to the top of the garage, then lowering himself onto the fence. From there, he finally dropped down to the ground. He threw out a thumbs up at his successful climb. He ran off towards his house without stopping, disappearing behind the side of another building. You had to admit that you were pretty impressed at how doable he made that look. He's a little parkour master. Cove always seemed to have a way of seeming so smooth without even meaning to. With a little sigh, you reclosed your window, deciding there was nothing more you could do. You hopped off your bed and got ready to head downstairs for the day. Let's see. Yeah, he just left. But I never make my bed. It was too early to do anything else. You took the stairs, slowly attempting to mask your face into a look of innocence. You were sure that someone would have come into your room if they had heard anything strange, but you couldn't be too careful. You had to play it cool. Play cool, calm and cool. Don't seem suspicious. Don't look suspicious. Don't look suspicious. When you stepped into the living room, Elizabeth was there, tapping her finger on the counter. Good morning, Elizabeth. She looked you over immediately, her eyes squinting at the greeting. Why are you being so weird? You hadn't even done anything. Brixies are never missed a beat, unfortunately. You turned and offered a tight smile, and her lips pursed together even tighter. Day? You shrugged it off, you clammed up. Wouldn't you like to know? Sorry. You excitedly bursted it out, and you folded it. Nah, I love getting spam. Oh, you got spam messages. We love spam messages. It's just so great, aren't they? Nah, we're shrugged it off. We gotta play it cool. Play it cool. I'm not. You spoke so nonchalantly, you almost thought she believed you. But you knew better. Further suspicious squinting occurred as she waited for something. But ultimately, she rolled her eyes, and you weren't sure if you were in trouble or not. She didn't seem to care enough to dig any further. Whatever. And then she walked straight out the front door, letting it slam shut behind her, and you let a brief sigh. Elizabeth went out most days to hang out with her friends from school out around town. Today, you were extra glad for it, though you were also grateful she hadn't left the house any sooner and risked running into Cove. It looked like you were getting away with that. Breakfast was eaten in peace and alone. Your moms were both out by the time you had gotten up. They had left you a serving of food from the breakfast they made. Hash browns, an omelette, fruit salad, and there were a few sausages like, oh hell yeah! Such a good breakfast. I want hash browns and sausage and an omelette. You took a little bit of everything. You passed on some parts because they weren't things you liked. You passed on some parts because you were trying to avoid meat. You passed on some parts because you were trying to avoid animal products. Oh yeah, so if you want to be like vegan or vegetarian in this game, you can do that too. Like this game is... our life has always been like very inclusive for like all types of people, like when it comes to like your looks, your eating habits, stuff like that, your gender identity. That's why I love this game so much. It's really immersive. Like it really gets into it, even down to like the little details. But I took a little bit of everything. It was tasty. You appreciate that there was a variety in the meals your mom's made. The day lazily drifted by at home, and eventually your parents returned. You pulled open the fridge again, lingering in the frosty air for a moment or two before grabbing a bottle of ice-cold water and taking a long drink. It was a perfect balmy summer afternoon, and you had decided to head outdoors and find something to do. You hadn't decided what that something was just yet, but you were sure something would pop up to occupy your time. As you were heading out the front door, you paused for a moment. You hadn't seen Cove since he had left that morning, and you couldn't help but think about what had happened to him. Would it be bad to go over to his house right now, or to call him to check in? You stepped out of your house, still stuck in an internal debate with yourself, when a voice caught your attention. Hi, Day! Ooh! Confused, you looked over to where an unrecognizable woman was waving at you, a friendly smile plastered on her face. You racked your memory for where you might have seen her before, but nothing came to mind. She's here! Not your school or from the country club your moms took you to. You had absolutely no idea who the woman was. The woman crossed the road towards you, and you were a little unsure of whether you should stay put or go back into the house and lock the door. There she is! Oops, I'm sorry. Was that presumptuous? I've heard about you, but you have no idea who I am, do you? You shook your head, and she removed her sunglasses to reveal sparkly ocean blue eyes. All of a sudden, she seemed a little more familiar. Everybody's screaming. My son lives here, and my ex, too. With a bent smile, she lifted a hand to point at the condo across the street from your own house. She was Cove's mom! You didn't know why you hadn't realized sooner, now that you'd gotten a good look at her. She seemed nice. She seemed so sort of strange. She looked really young. It made sense she was Cove's mom. She felt so different to Cove. She was super pretty. This beautiful lady was Cove's mother? Wow. No matter your thoughts on her, you still felt taken aback by that she had appeared here so suddenly. Cove mentioned she was coming, but you hadn't gotten the impression it would be the the very next day. Man, we got that one day delivery. She extended a hand again, this time for you to take, and you studied the manicured fingers in front of your face and an assortment of bracelets that dangled from her wrist. I'm Kira Priest. You can call me Kira. You shook her hand. Oh, be so fucking rude, don't shake it. That apple doesn't fall far from the tree. Exactly. You reached out and took her hand, and she shook yours firmly, grinning wide. I'm Dae, but you already knew that. Cove's mentioned you to me before. It's nice to officially meet you, Dae. Cove talked to you about his mom. He hadn't mentioned how he said things about you to her. It's like, oh my gosh, you talk about me with your mother? What's Cove said about me? Oh, I can't tell you that. I've already said too much. She laughed good-naturedly. You couldn't be happy about that answer, though. The sound of a door opening and closing caught both of your attentions, and when you turned towards the sound, it was to find Cove exiting his house, his eyes skimming the ground. Considering just how tall he had grown, you kind of figured his mom also would have been tall, but she was much more on the short side, for an adult anyway. Cove's height must have come from his father. There you are! Did you hear that? My baby! I thought you were going to keep me standing out here all day. You tried to catch Cove's eye as he walked towards you, but his gaze was firmly fixed on the sidewalk. When he finally crossed the road and looked up, he gave you a pitiful look. After the way he had acted last night, you knew he must be feeling pretty mixed up about this. You tried to wordlessly express that you understood. Cove and I are heading into town to grab something to eat while the snorer is at work. Kira beamed at Cove and ruffled his hair, which only seemed to upset him more. You assumed that the snorer she was talking about was Mr. Holden. Hey, you should come with us, Dae. I'd love to get to know you better. Yeah, you should come. There was a pleading tone and that you couldn't miss. Please, please come with me right now. Do not leave me with my mother. Of course we're running by your parents first. Responsibility and all that. You know, just little tee-hee adult things. Anywhoosie. It'll give me an excuse to meet them, which I need to do at some point. It's important to be neighborly if I'm going to be roosting on the street for the time being. Save him. We will, BB. Don't worry. Anywho's, let's go. Kira walked ahead towards your house and hung back with Cove, who crinkled his nose as he watched her. I'm sorry about her, but I really do want you to come. I don't want it to be just the two of us. Not right now. You leaned in close and whispered while checking around for anyone who might hear. What happened? Did your dad know you were gone? Cove shook his head and sighed heavily. Dad was so focused on mom showing up that he didn't even notice. I thought when I heard them on the phone last night that it was something they were planning for the future. This morning Dad said it was supposed to be a surprise, and I guess I was surprised. She's gonna be here all summer. Oh. You were surprised to hear that too. Cove sighed again, even heavier. I'll go with you, if you really want me to. He smiled, his shoulders relaxing a little in relief. Thanks, that'd be cool. I mean, she did invite us to. So, it should be all good. I mean, if she didn't invite us and she was like, please come with us anyway, I'd be like, I don't know, that's kind of weird. But she's like, oh my gosh, come with us. That child my son keeps talking about. Oh, there she is again. The two of you headed over to where Ko's mom had just knocked on your front door and stood behind her. Mom answered the door after a minute, her eyebrows lifting in surprise at the group she found in front of her. You realize that, like you, she would have no idea that it was Ko's mom who was hanging out with you. However, after blinking at the woman a couple of times and looking between her and Cove, the realization seemed to strike on her. Hello there, I'm Pamela. I see you met my kid, Dae, and I'm guessing you've already known Cove for a while. I see you already met Cove as well. Kira laughed, and you and Cove exchanged looks at your parents' weird sense of humor. I'm Kira Pierce. Priest. Cove's mom. It's so nice to meet you. A head of purple-brown hair caught your eye as Mom popped up behind Mom, squeezing herself in beside her. We have company. I was wondering what all the commotion was. She grinned excitedly at Kira. The two of them introduced themselves and shook hands. Hi, Dae. Cove. Cove smiled at Mom shyly. She gestured a hand towards the living room. There's no use hanging around in the doorway. Why don't you come in? I'd love to, but I promised to take my son out to eat, and I wouldn't want to hold you up with a surprise visit. Oh, I understand. You're welcome to stop by anytime. I'll take you up on the offer when I can. Count on it. Would you mind too if Dae went with Cove and I? My treat. We won't be driving. Just a quick walk down the road. Sure, that sounds nice. I hope you all have fun. You gave your moms a look, and they smiled at you fondly. You were happy they were letting you go. You were annoyed they agreed just like that. No, let them be happy. You could tell that Cove really needed the support, and you were ready to be there for him. Expect us back in an hour or two. We look forward to seeing you again. Take care. Your parents waved goodbye to the three of you as you backed up onto the street. There was the sound of the front door closing behind you. I'm pretty positive I saw some restaurants when I was in the taxi, not too far from here. Yeah, there's a lot of them around. The answer was straightforward and the tone was curt. Co Cove is usually more lighthearted than that. Water, he's gonna wash down all this food. Okay. And apples, oh my gosh. Everywhere. So much stuff. For little BB, let's see. Apple for me? Oh, okay, apple for me. Why do I get the healthy stuff? No, I'm just kidding. Okay, apple and water. Let's see. Oh, I already have apples on here, so I just need to put in the water. Where is it? Pictures, thank you for the redeems. Let's see. Water, right here at the end. Big. Hopefully he doesn't go on strike this time, yeah. You shouldn't be going on strike. You got all this food here. You better be grateful, bitch. Okay, we'll put this behind. Put it like right here. There we go. We can put it right here, actually. There you go. Put it on this side.
Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you guys indeed for providing the meal for BB. And then let's get the apples up. Where's the apples? I just saw it. There it is. Oh, my apples. There we go. My apples. Cut into little rabbits. Yes. Man, we got a whole little picnic here. It's like we're eating with them. With Kira and Cove. The answer was straightforward and cartoon. We're lying on that. Kira put her hands on her hips and smiled at her son. Well, you sound like the area expert. Do you have any recommendations for a place nearby? Not really. Kira pouted at him a little and turned to you instead. How about you, Dae? Wanna put me in the right direction? Yeah, sure, I have a couple favorites. You've been to a lot of places in town, and there were a couple that stood out from all the rest. There's a Chinese restaurant that me and my family go to all the time. It's my mom's favorite. There's also a tropical-themed place that tries to be sort of fancy. Both sound like a treat. I'll leave it up to you to pick for us, since Cove is going through a phase over there. He huffed at her and turned his face away. Which place should we go to, or should we make Cove picked? Or Kira? What restaurant you guys feeling? We've been to the Chinese place, Last Step. Although we didn't stay there for too long, because I think it was when... what's her name? What's my sister's name? Lizzie and Cove were fighting. But also, the tropical theme place is pretty pretty. It's pretty pretty. It's beautiful. Bum, bum. I need to close some things. There we go. Tropical? Okay. Tropical. Thank you, Dae. Will you show us the way? Oh my gosh, that rhymed. I will show you the way. You nodded, taking the lead of your little group as Cove and his mom followed behind you. Together, the three of you left the neighborhood behind. The walk was about 15 minutes, and along the way, Kira asked a lot of questions about the area. Cove was quiet most of the time, so you ended up answering her instead. Kira explained that she lived in a large city, and she loved how peaceful and relaxing everything seemed in Sunset Bird. The restaurant was busy as usual, but luckily you were shown right to the small table. Yeah, see? Pretty. Lots of plants. Kira lowered herself onto the chair, while Cove picked the one diagonal to her, not facing her or to her side. It was awkward. Wait, what? He picked one Oh, okay, I think I understand where he's sitting now. Let's see, to start, what would you all like to drink? I'll get an orange soda. Dae? I want juice. Which flavor? Ooh, lemonade. I was about to say apple, but I was like, oh, if you got lemonade here, then I'll take that. Kira placed the order for your drinks, getting a black hot coffee for herself, and it didn't take long before they were brought to the table and set in front of you. You took a long sip of your drink as you looked around the restaurant. Your small group checked over the menus, deciding what to order. Last time you came here, the dish you ordered was amazing. You wanted to order something different this time. Kira and Co. didn't need any encouragement for this. They were totally focused on the information in front of them. Her tattoo is pretty. It is. I do like that tattoo. It's a nice little sun tattoo. I want to get some tattoos, but I never know what to get. Or, like, where to even place them. Actually, it's kind of funny. I had a dream last night that I had got tattoos on my, my forearm. Which is kind of weird because, you know, I have the fur there, but I guess it was, like, shaved. And I don't know why I got them, but in my head I was like, yes, these are my tattoos, and I had to hide them from my family. I was like, I don't have any tattoos, what are you talking about? Like, my dad's side of the family, everybody's got, like, a tattoo of some sort, so, like, showing it to them would be fine, but, like, my mom's side, I don't think they'd be as supportive of the graffiti on my arms. So I was kind of like, oh, shit, I gotta hide this. Why'd I put it on my forearm? Should've put it on my bicep instead. But it was just a dream. I don't even remember what the tattoos were. They were kind of like little tiny drawings. Like, it was like four drawings on my arm. I think one of them was kind of like a little crude drawing of a dog, but I don't remember what the rest were. Soon the meals too were ordered and the menus taken away. You glanced at the table surface, waiting to figure out what to say. Cove sunk back further into his seat and avoided eye contact. He started to twiddle his thumbs while acting like this was all perfectly normal. His sour feelings today were unignorable. Instead of asking more open questions he'd brush off, Kira had mercy on her son and instead put her focus towards you. Ah, thanks. So, Dae, what's a few things that you're into? There's gotta be something you do for fun, especially now that you're not buried in school assignments. Ooh, well, oh my gosh, so many. Well, I go to the beach and I swim. You must be a strong swimmer since you live so close to the ocean. I find the water a little scary, but I still like to dip my toes sometimes. We look for seashells. I keep the best ones I find for my collection. I'm sure it's an incredible collection. And walk along the shore. That's a nice way to relax. I hope to be able to spend some time on the shore while I'm here myself. And that's it. And then I like to play games. Games are fun. I like to play video games. I don't know much about them. Maybe you can show me sometime. Oh, hey, yeah, I'll teach you. And card games. I like card games too. Maybe we can all play together sometime. Hell yeah. And what else do I do? I like to watch. Ah, there's no anime. No anime that I don't like to watch. Excuse me. I spend time on art. I create digitally. My computer at home doesn't really have all the programs I need. And I draw. I fill out a lot of sketchbooks. Oh, that's not me. I have never finished a sketchbook. Wait, that's a lie. I finished one. But that was like a really long time ago. And I think that's pretty much it. But I'm really into Cove. Hear a loud sudden laugh and Cove gasped beside you. It was dramatic enough to hail that he almost choked on the soda. You sure got the reaction. It was as truthful an answer to the question. Dae! Cove whispered at you disapprovingly, obscuring part of his face with a hand, but Kira only waved him off and encouraged you to go on. We spend time together, we can. I like it. Well, we have something in common. Kira smiled at Cove, who didn't look too impressed by either of you at that moment. She's like, oh, what, did you want to say that I hated you? Gosh. Be grateful, and that's it. I'm happy to learn more about you. There's so much I hadn't heard. Cove leaves the details out. He was trying not to pay attention, but you could tell he was uncomfortable. Hoping it would clear some of the tension there, you decided to ask Kira a few questions of your own. Cove hadn't told you much about her, and you were curious to know more about this woman who was such a big part of his life. What exactly do you do for work? I'm a travel writer for magazines and things. I keep people in the loop on what's worth seeing. It's good work. Wow. She gets to go to travel the world and write about it. It's like, you guys gotta go here. Maybe she'll write about this place. Where do you live normally? Nevada. Have you ever been there? You shook your head. It's a beautiful place. Check it out if you can. And what do you like to do? Spend time with my little boy, of course. And traveling. Real shock, huh? And these next few questions might be a little bit more personal. Okay, that last question. you know, I'll have some mercy. Maybe I shouldn't ask. Why did you get divorced? Did you cheat on him? Did he cheat on you? I didn't seem to bother that the conversation dropped off. Cove sipped his soda angrily, slurping up the remaining drink with furrowed brows. He looked ready to run straight out the restaurant. You weren't sure if coming along had ended up making the lunch better or worse. Let's see. Oh, you flicked straw paper at him. The wrapper hit Cove on the nose, and you had to bite down on your lip to keep from laughing. It took a couple of moments, but finally he cracked a smile, and that made you feel a little lighter inside. You two really seem really cute together. Cove covered his face with his hands and leaned back in his seat. Seriously? Why would you say that? Thanks, actually, we are cute. We are the most adorable
people in this restaurant besides you. Very. Your meals were delivered shortly after that, and everything was so delicious. Even Kova joined his food. Okay. Alright, now that we're all full and content, can you explain please why you've had a bug up your butt all day? Ko's face scrunched at that. Seriously, baby, what did Mom do to make you this mad? I haven't even been around a full day yet. He gripped the edge of the table, refusing to make eye contact. The words he spoke were barely audible over the dine of the restaurant. You could have told me. She leaned forward to not miss anything else, eyebrows raised. Told you what? He finally seemed to find his voice and spoke the thoughts that had been on his mind. That I wasn't going to visit you this year, that you were going to be coming instead. Didn't you invite me? You wanted me here, didn't with you? Ko's eyes began to shake and his frustration ebbed. I do want you to be around, but I didn't know it'd be like this. It's not the same, and nobody said anything. I see. Her expression grew tense. She threaded her fingers together and placed her hands in front of her on the table. We've both been gifted another Clifford surprise. So there you have it. The first antic Mr. Holden has gotten up to this step. Referring to that as a Clifford surprise almost caused both of you and Cove to crack a smile. You also had no idea his name wasn't just Cliff. Over 5 years, nobody have ever called him Clifford until now. Well, I mean, he's not a big red dog, so it kind of makes sense. She smoothed her hair out, not letting go of her stern look. The more things change, the more they stay the same. They let out identical sighs, but smiled weakly at one another afterwards. I can go home, Cove. We can still set up a normal trip to my place before the summer ends. Cove's lips tightly closed together. He seriously pondered the option. I think I do want you to stay. I miss it when you're not there. My heart! She reached across the gap, grabbed his face, and planted a kiss on his cheek. Cove tried to wiggle away. Mom, stop! I'm sorry. Sweet young men need to be smooched by their parents. If I don't, they'll take away my mom license. Kier was completely enthused by Cove's admission, though a tone of seriousness did return to her voice when the conversation continued. Do you want to talk to your dad, too? No. Cove had snapped the word instantly, but reeled his annoyance back just as quickly. Maybe later. Not today. I understand. We can shelve it. Thanks, Mom. Thank you for talking with me, little mister. She grinned affectionately at him before turning your way. And thank you, Dae. Huh? What'd I do? It's easy to act like a baby with your mom. It's hard to keep that up with your neighbor watching everything. Especially when you really care about what said neighbor thinks of you. She winked. Mom! She just ruffled his hair with a laugh, then moved her hand down to tap the end of his nose. And that was how the issue was resolved, at least between Cove and his mom. But not with Mr. Holden. Mr. Holden will get his comeuppance soon. When the three of you left the restaurant and Kira had paid the bill, you walked back to your neighborhood slowly. You had eaten so much by that time you were beginning to feel sleepy. It didn't help that the lunch had happened late and the sun was already beginning to descend from the sky. Oh, there he is! The villain himself! Jack's already swinging! But eventually you reached your street. Someone was there to greet your group upon arrival. Welcome back, family, and Dae too. Cliff. Dad. The two walked past to the condo without sparing another word. Despite the summer heat, their shoulders were cold. Uh-oh. I'm in trouble, you think? He rubbed the back of his neck with a crooked smile. But his eyes were soft as he looked on after them. He's so much like his mom, don't you think? He gave a vague nod, not sure what he was expecting you to do. He nodded back, far more energetically. Okay, have a nice night, Dae. You too, Mr. Holden. Curly hair. Yeah, he curled it. He's styling it now. With that, Cove's dad disappeared to join the others inside. It was your turn to go home now. Summer hadn't started off at all how you imagined it would've, though it turned out to set the tone well. Having Kier in the neighborhood was a new experience for not only you and Cove, but also both of your families. An adult moment was rarely had. Alright, and here we are. Wait, what's this? Oh! It's Derek's events. Thank you for purchasing Derek's DLC. Here you can play 5 new moments centered on Derek. He also has special epilogue in Step 4. To unlock it, you need to fulfill these conditions. Play all 5 of the Derek DLC moments, complete Saray with Cove, or by going alone is alright. So long as you finish the moment, choose to remain in touch with Derek during Step 3. Then you will have the option to play Derek's epilogue during Step 4, and you can only have 1 epilogue per playthrough. You can make a save on the epilogue section page to reload there and pick another later. Derek's DLC can be a friendship or romance story. Okay. So do you guys think that we should
save Derek's DLC for when we do his route, or do you guys want to do the friendship ones? Yeah, I mean, we'd have to redo them twice anyway. Well, I mean, like, if we do that, we could just save it for the next route and just focus on these cove ones. I mean, they can be friendship. I'll leave it up to you guys. I'm gonna go ahead and save before I forget. I say save it? Okay. We'll save it for Derek's route. Do Derek all at once. Okay. I think that is a good decision to make. And that way, it'll save us some time on today's stream if we're gonna get all of these done. But yeah, so... Actually, let me read them. So, we have Responsible Lemonade Soiree Siblings and a Boardwalk. Oh, wait, there's two Soirees. Oh, so one is Derek-specific and one is Cove-specific. Okay. All right. And basically, it said to do Derek's epilogue, we have to do all five of them and then go to the story with Cove. All right. I think that is good. So those five will be done for next time. So with that, what do you guys want to start with? Escapade. Okay. Jack was ready. Escapade. You looked up, noticing the sun was finally setting. You'd been trying to delay the end of the day for as long as possible. The evening breeze tickled your nose as you sat on your front porch, munching on a fresh watermelon slices. The snack made you happy. You thought watermelon was just okay. You were eating it just because watermelon was a slum tradition. You weren't even sure why you were eating it. I like watermelon flavored things, but the watermelon itself, I'm not really the biggest fan of. I think it's just okay. Most of the time, I don't know. I feel like when it comes to some fruits that I like or don't really like, it's just because I pick like a bad batch or something. It's like with apples. It's like sometimes I'll eat an apple, but it doesn't taste really like anything. And like with watermelon too, it just tastes like water, you know? I know, crazy. Watermelon tastes like water. It's a no-no texture for me, watermelon. Yeah. It's just wet and soggy. But the flavorings though, the flavorings are good. Well, hopefully we got a good batch here that doesn't have a rough texture. It was okay. You're debating on whether or not you should eat another slice. It was alright, an alright sweet snack, but you were still content from dinner. You turned to look at Cove. You had both been sitting in comfortable silence for a while now. He sat next to you, close enough for your shoulders to touch. He was happily absorbed in his thoughts and his own slice of watermelon. Chuckling, you watched as his face twisted in discomfort. He had to stop chewing to spit a seed into the bush. I bet I can spit a seed farther than you. Immediately, you shoved the majority of what was left in your watermelon slice into your mouth just to get a seed to prove your point. Just like shoves the whole thing in. As soon as you could, you sent that seed sailing into the middle of the street. Did you see that, Cove? Cove burst into laughter that slowed it to a wide grin. You could tell he was equal parts surprised and impressed. Can you do that again? I didn't see where it landed. Of course I can. You popped another seed into your mouth and focused on where the last one landed. Setting the seed free, you got it to go even further this time. Not bad. Not bad. You heard Cove chuckling again. It was taking a lot of focus to stay looking serious and not to break into laughter yourself. I'd like to see you try. I will. Cove took in a mouthful of watermelon, face grimacing when he had the seed. Then his expression morphed into a focused look, and he sent the seed flying, landing in a similar spot to yours. Wait, you got to do two. I need another try. He spoke before you could even comment on his non-victory. His determination got you laughing. He quickly sent another closer to where your second one landed. Seems we're evenly matched. For now. For the next several minutes, you both kept carving seeds from your slices and giggling at the ridiculousness of the competition. Eventually, a truce was called, and you both went back to eating the neglected watermelon flesh. I wonder if we'll have another slice after this one. That one is your third already. Is that bad? It tastes really good. Unable to resist, you knocked the mostly finished slice out of his hand. Hey! There was no chance saving it. He was fully unprepared to defend it. The watermelon slice slapped on the ground, accompanied by a fit of your laughter. What was that for? There wasn't much laugh. You wanted another anyway. Really? I love that option. Just wham! Just slap it right out of his hand. Can't get you another one then. He said shook at your logic, but there was only amusement in his eyes. It was pretty funny. The two of you were able to smile together again, and he did take that fourth piece. A little while later, Cove flinched, making a confused sound. He suddenly put his current slice down on the plate next to him. Are you okay? Yeah. He stood up, head tilted back to look at the sky. His feet took him to the middle of the street. Did you notice anything? What do you mean? I felt a raindrop. The sun's still out. You put down your watermelon slice and hopped off of your front step. Immediately, you felt a tap of water on the crown of your head, making you yelp. You're right! No melon for you! No more melon. But oh my gosh, it's sun raining! It's sun raining, bro! Cove was still staring up at the sky, and you watched as he began blinking more rapidly. When he finally turned in your direction, his face was bemused. It's a sun shower! It seemed crazy, but soon you couldn't avoid the drops that began increasing into a light shower. Booming with laughter, Cove kicked off his shoes towards his front door and reveled in the moment. You were annoyed. You were excited. You closed your eyes and threw your head back, letting the rain shower over you. The cool drops felt so right after the warmth of the day. Feeling energized, you ran over to Cove and laughed at how soaked he already was. Not that he cared, because he was busy spinning in the middle of the street. Following his lead, you spun yourself until you were dizzy. Just as suddenly as the sprinkling started, it stopped and left you dripping with the smell of wet asphalt and soil tickling your nose. Oh my god, he all wet. You all wet, I ain't gonna take you home, you all wet. Oh god damn, your feet all wet. Cove caught your eyes, running a hand through his wet hair, combing it back. He frowned.
It's over. I wanna spin too.
Oh, you wanna spin too, BB? You could spin. Wait. Shit, the scene's too big. Whoa! Wait, here we go. Wow! There he goes! He's spinning! Well. You spinning in the sun shower, baby. Till you're dizzy. Okay, that's enough. Did you like that? Did it even show up on the thing, or was he just invisible the whole time?
Spying.
I'm glad you had a good time, Biebs. Ah, shit. I'm trying to put the chat back in my OBS because it was blocking. Ah, I don't want to put it. Just trying to make a new window. But it was up so high before. Ah, fine. Stay right there then.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I'll spin you around. I'll grab BB's paw and just, like, start twirling him. Throw him up into the sky and catch him. Our favorite pastime. The drops of rain clinging to his face almost could have been mistaken for tears. He sounded that disappointed. I wish it lasted longer. I've had enough rain for summer day. Did I say anything? You were charmed. Oh, he's so charming. There was still a spark of amusement dancing in his eyes from the sun shower, and you couldn't help but smile from ear to ear. What? Nothing. Just thinking about how fast you committed to getting soaked. He chuckled bashfully. Yeah, it was pretty cool. You then looked over at your door inside. You knew Ma wasn't going to be happy to see you trailing water into the house. Cove rubbed his arm awkwardly. He must have been thinking the same thing because he watched you sympathetically. Okay. You can dry off at my house if you want. My parents won't mind. Thanks, I'll do that. You're the sweetest. Cove, you're the sweetest guy I know. I don't want to cause trouble. I'm fine. I don't want to cause any trouble. You won't, really. My parents make bigger messes than that all the time. It's okay. Then can I at least sit out here with you until you can go inside? I don't want you to have to do that. I'll go with you. Yeah? Okay. His whole demeanor brightened. You figured he must have felt relieved to help you avoid getting in any trouble. Cove led you inside, and you stayed close to him. We have a ton of spare towels. I've just got to dig them out of the hall closet. Oh, I think I'm going to need to borrow some clothes from you too. Oh, and looking. What should I do? Just hang out in the living room. Okay. And maybe don't sit on the couch. You answered him with a light smile. Yeah, good idea. But that Cove disappeared and returned in no time, towels in hand. Here. Thanks. You accepted one and began to pat yourself down. A sudden call caught both of your attentions. I thought I heard voices. Cove's mom strolled into the living room with a curious grin. What happened here? You're both wet. You're both all wet. There was a sun shower. Badass. Oh, hell yeah. Badass. Cove smiled back at his parent. We came inside to dry off. My mom's don't want me going into my house when I'm wet. So I told Dae to come back here. That was very sweet of you, baby. It was very badass. She ruffled Cove's wet hair and laughed at the drops of water that shook off, and a light came to Kira's eyes. I have an idea. Why don't we go for a drive? It has to beat standing around the house, and you'll air dry in no time. Co who only offered a shrug, and Ben smiled to his mom. He looked at Chief for a real answer.
Yeah, let's do it.
Fun. This'll be good. Kira pulled out her cell phone from her pocket to call your mom's. They had swapped numbers early in the summer. Head on out to the garage. I'll meet you there in just a minute. My mom can be so pushy. She gets some idea in her head, and that's what she does. That's okay. Thanks for letting me come. I didn't do anything. That wasn't true at all, but you let him get away with that. You can get away with it for now. Come on. Cove led you to the car, and Kira wasn't too far behind. Okay, into the back, you two. Once the three of you were situated inside, Kira started and drove out of the residential area. When she hit a main road, the car sped up and she rolled the back windows down all the way. Hey! Cove started laughing as he kept trying in vain to keep his hair from flying into his eyes too much. Meanwhile, you closed your eyes as the wind whipped against your wet clothes. I said this drive was going to be good for getting air dried. Yeah, but I didn't agree to this much air. Cove tried pressing the window button, but nothing happened. His eyebrows furrowed in frustration. You disabled the back? Sorry, I can't hear you. The wind's too much in my ears. But I love riding in the car and having just the wind down. The wind flowing into my hair. It's such like a, I don't know. It's a vibe, you know? It sends me to a place of comfort. Whenever I remember, I have a lot of memories of whenever we go to a campsite, if we'd be swimming for the day, and then when we would go home, that's what I would do a lot to air dry my own hair. I would be sitting in the back seat with the window down, just my head sticking out, trying to get it dry. It was nice. Smiling deviously, Kira turned on the radio and turned it up to be heard over the wind. You laughed and enjoyed the moment. You jokingly complained about the situation. You were not a fan of the stunt. You danced in your seat to the music. I am enjoying this. You yelled into the wind and burst into laughter. Looking over at Cove, you saw him relax. He seemed glad that you were having fun. Paper. And then something struck the side of your leg. Several papers were freed from under the car seats and were blown about. They can't go out the windows. Cove began to haphazardly reach around the space to try and get it all back under wraps. Amused, you helped. Mom, close the windows. Kira offered no response other than a chuckle. She just kept driving. Cove snatched several of the papers out of the air, and you caught others, preventing most of them from flying out the window on your side. You showed Cove your collection while grinning widely. I think we got pretty much all of them. You figured if they were sitting out in the back of the car, they couldn't be important enough to get upset over, but Cove continued to look annoyed. Who keeps like a stack of papers in the car anyway? What did they say? Read their contents. Your smile started to slip, and that his expression stopped, and I hope so. Thanks for helping. The sun set completely, and at that, Kira rolled up the windows. Cove let out a big sigh and released the random bits of paper he had in his fists. Your mom is crazy. He ran a hand through his windblown hair and laughed with a bit of exasperation. You felt good. The evening had really turned out to be more interesting than you expected. Grinning, you were happy with your odds with whatever else happened next. Cove watched you with interest until his focus was taken by a new comment from his mom. Bet you're not feeling damp anymore. No, but now I feel tricked. But it's fun. We'll side with him. Yeah, you didn't tell us you'd trap us like that. My bad. Kira continued driving. The radio volume was just adjusted for the closed windows, and everyone was sitting more comfortably. Kira lowered the sound even more after pulling into a red light. She took the chance to turn around and caught her coy smirk. Does anyone know what we drove past during the dry cycle? I'm not sure I want to. A movie theater. Okay, most places have one somewhere. It isn't that late, you know. We could probably still catch a show. Really, Mom? We don't even know what we'll be playing. That's what makes it fun. Oh, hell yeah, badass. Let's go to the movies. Both of you? Why not? You seemed hesitant. You gave him a smile, and Cove eased up a bit. Aw, don't get me wrong. I'm not advocating impulsive behavior every day, but it's important to seize the moment when you can. We may never have another night like this. Exactly. When opportunity strikes, you better take it, because you may never get it again. And don't worry, Dae. I said I'd watch you for the night, not just 10 minutes or so. I'll put your parents in the loop about hitting the movies as soon as we get there. I didn't bring any shoes. Oh yeah, that's right, they're still kicked off up back on the sidewalk. I am advocating for it. Live happy. Exactly. Why suppress having fun? I'm not wearing any either. You lifted your foot and wiggled your toes so Cove could see. How are we going to go inside barefoot? I don't know. We'll sneak through quick. No one will notice. You can do it, just once. You bounced in your seat excitedly that it was actually going to happen. Kira was right. You never got to do stuff like this. You never get to go to the movies barefoot. Kira drove into the theater parking lot and shut the engine off. With the unbuckling of her seatbelt, she ushered Yu and Cove out. Despite being hesitant to leave, once outside, Cove burst into a sprint towards the cinema. Oh my god, he's running! You were right along with him. The tarmac was still wet from before and cold to stand on with bare feet. Inside, you noticed there were no lines. All the current shows had already started. Kira paid that no line and strode up towards the counter with some words of encouragement. A third of the running time is ads these days. We haven't missed anything. Meanwhile, Ko stood next to you awkwardly. He shifted from one foot to the other and constantly kept looking around. His shady behavior would have made him much more likely to get caught than standing still would have if there were people around to really notice. It was pretty goofy. Ko, you a goofy-ass bitch. You cheesed him over it. And I thought you loved being barefoot. Outside. On the bright side, I bet you'll never forget about your shoes again, huh? Never. Will you? Probably not. Listening a sigh of relief out of you, Kira returned with the tickets in hand. She quickly herded you and Cove towards the showing room. I am so sorry for the little hiccup, but hold on. We've almost made it home free. Once we sit down, it'll be smooth sailing. The lights were already off in the showing room, but the movie hadn't started yet. The upcoming movie trailers were still playing. Yes! Keeping her volume in a hushed tone, Kira couldn't help but burst with excitement over your luck. You followed her down the walkway until she spotted open seats in the middle-ish area of the theater. Kira pointed at the seats, looking over her shoulder at you and Cove, waiting for input. Cove nodded, and you decided to give her a thumbs up, and she led the way. When you reached your seats, Kira sighed contentedly. Cove gave a sigh of his own and lifted his feet to sit cross-legged instead of keeping them down on the floor. He then leaned over and whispered to you. Do you have any idea what that movie is? No, I didn't hear the name or anything when your mom bought the tickets. Oh boy. After a couple more previews, the main event began. It dawned on you quickly that this was a horror film, one about a group of students being haunted by dangerous ghosts. Uh-oh. Ooh, spooky. Ooh, scary. You know, there isn't really that many horror movies I've seen in my lifetime, and the ones I have seen, I get a little spooked over, so... nervous. It might get too loud for you. You struggle with frightening themes. I don't like the jump scares. I hate jump scares so much. Can't stand them. It might get too loud. You didn't usually choose to attend activities that had a lot of noise, and movie theaters were one of those. A horror movie might have screams and crashes and all sorts of other things. Glancing over at Cove, you noticed that he looked less than thrilled with the movie. He bit down on his bottom lip and stared at the screen with trembling eyes. Cove had never been a fan of ghosts or intentionally frightening things. That was something you learned about him from early on. Let's see, you remained still. You tapped Cove on the shoulder to get his attention. You angled your body and you stood close to him. Let's hold hands, it's okay. Your fingers wrapped tight around his, and he jumped slightly at the unexpected touch. But his expression softened when he peeked at you out of the corner of his eyes. He watched you with an unspoken question written all over his face. Will you be okay? Yeah, it'll be okay. He gave your hand a squeeze to silently voice support. That made you feel good. Sometimes the other people in the theater screamed or jeered or clapped, depending on what was happening. Your heart was pounding in your chest when the movie finally came to an end. The main character resolved the hauntings, but in the dark conclusion, they didn't make it out alive. I hate jump scares and gore. Yeah, me too. I mean, some gore is okay. Like, light gore I can handle, but like the big stuff? No, I can't stand that. It's not good. You stayed to let the credits roll and for the theater to clear out. Then it was time to head back to the car. Both you and Ko took the same seats in the back of the car again, even though it was like Kira was exuding an optimistic energy. We survived it! Your nerves were still calming down from the movie. Ko gave you a worried glance and then a hard look at his mom. The movie wasn't ever going to kill us, it was going to make us unhappy. She deflated a little at the chastising. Sorry, gang, I didn't know it'd be that bad. It made me really tense. I guess that's the point of horror stuff, but I kind of don't want to have to feel like that. There's nothing wrong with that. It's not for everyone. You narrowed his eyes defensively at the attempt to encourage him. Yeah, it wasn't just me either. Aw, Dae, how are you feeling? It really scared me, I hated it. It wasn't as bad as I thought it would be. It was scary, but I had fun. Yeah, I mean, it was still fun. Kira smiled a little more at that. I'm glad. I still can't believe you died. It's nice when the things aren't all obvious and you don't really know how it'll end until you see it, but I wanted it to go better. I demand a happier ending. I loved how it all fell apart when it seemed like things were going to be okay. I saw it coming, you know, along with what Ko was saying. It was so lame. I prefer the happier endings in horror movies. I mentioned this before, but I don't really watch, even though I don't watch horror movies, I do watch this YouTube channel called Dead Meat where they do kill counts from horror movies, but like over time they've like started implementing like putting in like more of the story and like the behind the scenes stuff. So I like watching those videos. And like most of the time, like horror movies have such like a bad ending. I want it to be resolved. I want things to be happy. I can't handle any. I have some set of phobia or something, but it gets my anxiety up. Yeah. I can understand that. It's not something that you can really help. No horror games from Jackstream in the future. Oof, I'm burping. I do kind of want to try to play a bit more horror games. Maybe in October. I feel like October I was planning to have like a whole month of just horror games. But we'll see how that goes. We'll see if I stick to it. I don't know, maybe after the horror of Subnautica, I might decide against it. Only FNAF, maybe. Yeah. Oh my gosh, but that's like Jump Scare City right there. And that's just screaming in faces. But we'll see. Or Phasma with the game. We should play Phasmophobia. That'd be so much fun. I have that. I used to play it a lot. I'd get so terrified. I remember like this one scene where this one moment in Phasma where my friend and I were playing and we were in a house and he had to go into the closet to fix something on his computer, and I just like immediately went in with him, and he's like, oh no, nothing's happening, I'm just fixing my computer. And then all of a sudden a hunt started with the ghost and it was so terrifying. And after that I was like, listen bitch, if you're going in the closet, I'm going in there too. I ain't staying out here by myself. But it's a lot of fun. I do like Phasmophobia. I haven't played it in a while. And I think like a lot of new stuff has been put into it as well. Maybe Phasmo collab in the future. You and Co spent the rest of the car ride absorbed in conversation about the movie. So, who's hungry? You're surprised when you realize Kira didn't drive you home, but to a drive-thru burger restaurant and said, hell yeah, fast food. I like it, but I'm a wuss. Yeah. Me too. Yeah, why not? Let's eat. That's the spirit. Get whatever you want. Ooh, I want chicken sandwich. I want, fries. I want mozzarella sticks. And I want a milkshake. And that's everything. Is that alright? It's A-okay. Cope was tickled by the size of your list and had no disapproval over it. But the size of my list, I got 4 things. That doesn't even take up all of my fingers on my paw. Kira pulled up to the window and ordered what you asked for first. She then decided to order one of everything on the value menu. Mozzarella sticks? Yes, mozzarella sticks! I love mozzarella sticks. I always pick mozzarella sticks. Always. If a restaurant or a fast food place has them, I'm getting them. You best know that. Whoa, what are you gonna do with all that? Eat it? The whole menu? Even after Dae picked most of that already? But bitch, I didn't pick like a fraction of it. I didn't pick the whole thing, damn. I am a fiend for mozzarella sticks. But I did not pick that much. You know what? I was gonna share my fries and my mozzarella sticks with you, Co, but you know what? Fuck that. You're on your own. That's right. There are only maybe 10 things on it, and they're about $1 each. I can swing it. And besides, whatever we don't finish, I'm gonna feed to your dad. He'll be in heaven. Cove sighed affectionately at his mother's antics. Thank you. You're quite welcome. A few minutes later, Kira exchanged her money for multiple bags of food, which she quickly tossed to you both in the back seats. She then drove off into the night. Can you pass me something? What should I grab? Surprise me. You chose one of the wrapped sandwiches and handed it to her. You had no idea if it was a burger or something else. Thanks very much. Have you ever been to a fast food place that had mozzarella sticks? I think... Doesn't Burger King have mozzarella sticks? I think so. Or am I thinking of Arby's? I know there's some fast food places. Fast food places with mozzarella sticks. Like, I'm sure... Okay, Dairy Queen has mozzarella sticks? Hello? McDonald's does not have mozzarella sticks. If they do, that's a lie, because my McDonald's does not. If it did, I'd be getting them with every one of my meals. I guess that really just depends on the area that you're in. Cause I feel like my Burger King had mozzarella sticks, but maybe some Burger Kings don't. Cause the McDonald's has mozzarella sticks, I sure as hell doesn't. I demand it be required for all fast food restaurants to have mozzarella sticks. That's the rules that I am putting in here. Accepting this was what was happening. Cove shrugged and started pulling food out of the bags for himself. Cove ended up with some onion rings, and he happily munched on them. You selected something randomly? You made sure to grab something you liked. Let's go random. You weren't even questioning Kira's crazy ride anymore. The adventure continued, and you were so preoccupied in the back that you almost didn't realize the car had stopped. Kira turned to look over her shoulder. Okay, party people. It seems we reached the end of the road. Confused, you checked out the window and saw nothing except empty road ahead. And then you noticed it. The now leaving sign. Kira took you through the entire town. What are we doing here? Kira turned the car around and parked it along the side of the road. I think you both could use a break to stretch your legs, and I doubt anyone is going to come through here this time of the night. Besides, I need to make a call, so go on. Cove shook his head and got out of the car without a fight. You followed him. Here we are, back again. You got out and caught up to Cove. He was busy looking at the stars and stretching his arms while he strolled around. You thought being there was exciting. You're delighted with the wide open sky above and the unobstructed view of the landscape around. It was freeing. It's amazing we're all the way out here. Cove smiled, glancing from the stars to you. Shortly after, you noticed Cove's expression changed. His eyebrows furrowed, and it seemed like he was thinking hard about what he wanted to say next. Dae, I am really sorry for my mom being crazy tonight. She isn't always like this. Seriously. Why is she being like this now? I think she feels like she has to get out there and do things with me while she can, and she wants to make the time memorable. This visit has been really different than the others, and it didn't start off good. Thinking about how Kira's trip began this summer, you could understand why Cove was thinking along those lines. She probably wanted all the trouble to be worth it in the end. Are you having a good time with your mom around? Yeah, it's still weird having her and Dad in the same house, but I love her. She's my mom. I like hanging out with her. Most of the time. It was time between you both, so you jumped when you heard the sound of a car door closing. Cove, Dae. Oh my gosh, that's our ship name. Dae. You turned to see Kira by the driver's side, waving. The sight brought a smile to Cove's face, and she quickly made her way over to where you both were standing. Thanks for waiting. I didn't mind. How did I end up with such a polite boy? She ruffled his hair and Cove lowered his head, accepting the compliment. You thought about how interesting it was to see how Cove interacted with his mom. And then the memory hit you. That first summer, you and Cove came to this very spot in his runaway attempt to find his way back to his mom, and now you were all here, together. Ooh. Should we expose him? Just say, like, remember that time you tried to run away to go see your mommy, and we ended up right here? Whisper. Taking a step closer to Cove, you leaned in close to share the moment just with him. Isn't it strange that your mom took us here? This is where you went to try to see her when you moved to Sunset Bird. Cove flinched and his eyes darted over to his mom, worried that she'd heard. When he was satisfied she didn't, he turned back. Yeah, it's weird, but she doesn't know what happened. At least I'm pretty sure she doesn't. Really? Dad likes to tell her things are fine. She doesn't worry. You decided to inform Kira. It's like, hey, Kira! Did Cove's dad ever tell you that he tried to run away and go see you here? I need to keep a secret. Cove looked at you gratefully, and you shared a conspiratorial smile. Anyways, it's kind of cool to be here, right on the edge of town. Exactly, we're standing on a precipice. I think so too. I knew you'd get it. It's good to appreciate these times and places. Kira let out a big breath of air. We should probably call it a night, huh? Mm-hmm. Why, it's over? More fun. You kind of hoped some other unexpected thing would pop up to keep things going. Kira shyly smiled and gestured to the car. Quietly, you all made your way back to it. Cove naturally followed you, taking the seat nearby in the back with a collection of fast food bags still strewn about. You rested your head into the seat as the car roared to life. As you did, Cove leaning close to whisper. I can talk to your moms if they do get mad about tonight for some reason. It was my mom's idea. You didn't have a choice. This was worth it even if they get mad. We gotta live a little. Having a good time is worth more than getting people mad at you, you know? Your mouth pulled into the biggest grin, getting a laugh out of Cove. If you say so. Cove smiled bashfully at you, but said nothing else. Drive home was smooth and uneventful. The radio was completely off, and you felt your eyelids getting heavy.
Your head came to rest on Cove. You're too tired to keep your head up, and it felt quite comfortable there. Cove didn't have any issues there. He leaned into it. You must have been exhausted, too. You were happy to stay close like that. It was warm and comfortable. When you opened your eyes, you expected to still be in the car, not your bedroom. It was somehow already morning. You couldn't remember how you ended up there. Oh my gosh, our mom's so strong. She must have came out and picked us up and carried us up here. Sitting up in bed, you thought about how last night was quite an experience. It almost felt like a dream more than a real event, but it definitely happened. And you were glad that you got to have a spontaneous escapade this summer. Alright, and we are back. A nice little moment with Cove and his mommy. Or it was Cove. Oh my gosh. How romantic, and we'll never know. It's just between us and whoever carried us up there. Maybe it was Kira. Maybe she's like super strong too. It could be anybody. Oh my gosh, I have to clean this real quick. Growing? Okay, we do growing next. Let me wipe this down real quick. A little messy. Ah! I'm gonna go ahead and click on it. Did I save? That doesn't matter. Early one afternoon, you found yourself in the living room with your family. It was another one of those summer days where it felt too hot to go outside, but it was too uncomfortable to do anything inside either. The air conditioner was cranked up as far as you could negotiate it, but everyone was still being pretty lazy. Your mom's, and sisters were lounging around while the TV blared on in the backdrop, ignored by all of you. You specifically were lying spread eagle on the carpet, sitting cross-legged on the floor, perched on the arm of the couch, draped over the coffee table. What? Why don't I get my own couch to just lay on? Hello? Rude. I'm flying spread eagle on the carpet, flat on the back. You stared up at the ceiling, your eyes unfocused and mind clear of all thoughts. That's what I do sometimes. Like, sometimes after, like, a streaming session, and I'm, like, waiting for, like, stuff to, like, upload onto, like, the VOD channel and all that, I'll just, like, lay down on the floor. It's surprisingly comfortable. It really helps the back. Elizabeth broke the silence with a loud groan. You glanced over. She was lying on her back over the couch, massaging her calf with one hand. I feel terrible. I'm dying in this house and my legs hurt. Mom looked up from the magazine she'd barely been flipping through and frowned, concerned. Could you have strained them somehow? Elizabeth flailed briefly, then flopped onto her side with a heavy sigh. I don't know, it just hurts. Sweetheart. Ma got up from her seat at the kitchen table and walked over to your sister. She did a light pat on Elizabeth's shoulder sympathetically. I'm sorry you have to deal with that. Maybe it's growing pains. Could be taller by next fall. Elizabeth scoffed. She didn't look impressed by Ma's assessment. I'd rather be my height forever than deal with this. Mom walked over to you, leaning against the back of the couch. Kids, they grow up so fast. She starts crying. Soon Elizabeth will have a home of her own. Maybe even with a nice husband and some kids if she feels like it. She sniffled loudly, wiping her eyes. She could tell that it was just a bit. You tilted your head. Even though you knew Elizabeth liked guys, it was hard to imagine her with a boyfriend or a husband. She only seemed invested in hanging out with her group of friends, not chasing after boys. She's independent. She don't need no man. She's also only 15, so... let her hang out with her friends. Mom must agree with you because she shook her head. Let's not exaggerate. She's still practically a child. Exactly. But if you ever do pursue romance, Elizabeth, you can come talk to me about it. Definitely. We're always willing to lend an ear. Elizabeth's features contorted in disgust. No way! I am not talking to my moms about that. Mom's jaw dropped and she gasped in an exaggerated display of shock. Her hand came up to rest against her chest. Ma only grinned. She didn't look offended by Elizabeth's quick response at all. It really wouldn't be so bad to come to us. I know what it's like to have a crush on a pretty boy or two. I don't, but I can listen anyway. Mom snorted her own joke, while Mom burst into giggles. They were having a little too much fun at Elizabeth's expense. Elizabeth certainly wasn't feeling the amusement because she rolled her eyes and sat up. I'm going back to my room. I'd rather melt alone, thanks. Bye. She strode off towards the staircase, taking the steps two at a time. Your mom stared after her, then turned to each other with raised eyebrows. Whoops, looks like we scared her off with all that romance talk. Oh well, we'll get her next time. You watched them titter with some surprise. Obviously, your mom's like women. Really? I didn't think that was obvious. Did you guys know our moms liked women? I didn't. I wonder what gave it away. But you had no idea that Ma liked guys, too. Today was the first time you'd heard her say something like that. She's bisexual. Ma, I thought you only liked ladies. You like guys, too?
Ma turned to you, happy to bring you into things now that you'd spoken up. She smiled and nodded. That's right. I like both. But I like your mom most out of everyone. She's special. Ma's smile turned all soft in the corners, like it usually did when she looked at her. She pinched Mom's cheek lightly. Ma reached up to cup a hand over Ma's. Even when Ma stopped pulling her cheek, her hands remained clasped together. What gave that impression? Mr. Holden will steal Ma. I'm still calling. Oh my gosh, she's gonna ruin this family. Thanks, Lonnie. I think most women have charm, but no one can hold a candle to you. Pamela. Ma beamed, and then kissed Mom on the cheek she'd been pinching before. You thought their moment was very sweet. You cringed.
Cringe, ew. Parents, so embarrassing.
She slouched down as if that would hide you from sight. Why were parents like that?
Uh-oh. They're approaching.
Ma looked back at you, letting Mom's hand go with a brief squeeze. She settled down next to you, and Mom followed her soon after. You know, I'm also here to listen to you whenever you're ready. That offer isn't just for Elizabeth. In fact, I think that talk might be needed sooner for you. After all, you already have someone, isn't that right? Mom shook her head and elbowed Ma, but it was futile. Meddler.
Ma!
Ma only giggled and smiled, not looking the least bit apologetic. There's no rush, of course. You can take all the time you need to figure out what or who you want. Don't think you have to stick with whatever you come up with right now, either. Life's nice like that. It can change and you can learn. That is true. Life does change. I can relate to that. Mom nodded her agreement. The two of us are happy to hear you out. We may be able to relate better than you think. Still, we won't push the topic, at least most of the time. She gave Mom the weakest scathing look possible while being unable to stop grinning. Thanks. You nod silent, you shrug. Yeah, you don't have to worry about that. We're your parents, sweetie. We'll always worry. Mom let out another exaggerated sniffle. It didn't take a genius to realize it was fake.
First Elizabeth, and now you, Dae? Do you have to grow up?
Yes. Children tend to do that from time to time. Your parents quickly grew absorbed in the conversation about rearing kids. You took that as your cue to leave, getting up so you could spend some time alone in your room, too. They let you go without problem, so you made your way up the stairs. You let out a sigh once you stepped into your room. It was just as sweltering in there as it was in the living room, possibly even a little warmer. You couldn't even open your window since it was hotter outside. You just have to let the AC out. You dragged your feet as you crossed the room. You checked your current sweltering condition in the mirror as you passed by it. You thought back to the conversation you'd had downstairs, about growing up and all that. After a moment, you stepped a bit closer to the mirror. You stared into it, and then turned away from the surface to look down at yourself. You were definitely growing, alright. It was weird thinking about how you were in it now, in comparison to what you'd been when you were younger. When it came to your body, it was getting some muscle definition nowadays, was chubby, was slender, was heavyset, was sort of scrawny. I mean, we're kids. We're children. It's a little bit chubby. You shifted to the side. Your head was still facing forward and continue with the self-evaluation from this viewpoint. Okay, so at birth, you were assigned female, and what you were born with has impacted the way your body grew, but it wasn't what really determined who you were. When it came to your figure, your chest was flat now, but that would likely get changed at least a little as you get older. You were starting to develop breasts. You already had noticeable boobs. You aim not to have breasts through hormone therapy. What route do I want to go down? We're just starting. Staying sideways, it was easy to notice a slight increase in that area. You reached over and massaged your scar with one hand, staring intently in the mirror. By now, you knew that it was there to stay. You took a step backwards, finished it with your impromptu inspection. You locked eyes with your reflection, cocking your head to the side. All things considered, you thought you looked fantastic. You didn't look too bad. You had no idea how to feel. You were simply neutral, self-conscious. You just wanted to look different than you did. I don't know. Emotions are hard to figure out when you're at that age. At any age, to be honest. You tilted your head over to the opposite side, as if that would help you make up your mind. It didn't. You shook your head roughly, putting thoughts of what you were turning into out of your mind. This wasn't the time to focus on such things. You had to find something to do in this heat. You shuffled over to your bed, collapsing onto the mattress. Your brow scrunched up in thought. Time passed slowly, and to your annoyance, possible ideas about what to do were few and far between. You weren't sure how long it had been, but eventually you heard your mom call you from downstairs. Dae! There's a call for you. Cobe wants to come over. Is that all right? You parked up at the words, sitting up in bed. You yelled back to her immediately. Yeah.
Hell yeah. It's badass.
You got to your feet and headed downstairs, eager to see your friend. You needed to go downstairs soon anyway, because your empty stomach told you it was almost time for lunch. Just as you reached the bottom of the stairs, you saw Ma put the phone back on the receiver. She glares at Ma, leaning her hip against the kitchen counter. Well, here comes trouble. We better prepare ourselves. Ma clicked her tongue in clear disapproval of Mom's words. He's such a good boy. Cove never wants to cause trouble. He can just be a bit thoughtless and impulsive. Oh, I know. He's very sweet, but that's what makes it more of a problem. If a stranger or some kid from school was egging Dae on to behave badly, I think we can both agree that they'd do the right thing in the end. But if Cove Holden got into a reckless mood and wanted Dae to be a part of that ride, can we really be certain of what call they'd make then? Yes, we can, Pamela. Dae would do whatever Cove wanted. Oh, pfft. Dang. They really... Come on, Ma. Have some more faith in me, damn. We ran away one time, and that was it. Your mom giggled freely at Mom's reaction. You worry too much about those two together. Look, all I'm saying is that I haven't forgotten the time when they were kids and tried to run away together. Why are they coming for us like this? I know. Listen, all that talk before about growing up, we had a little parent moment. Now they're like, oh my gosh, I can't believe Cove. Cove's gonna make Dae do something bad. Like running away or drugs. Ma just laughed, and as she turned away, still snoring, her eyes met yours. She blinked in surprise, then waved at you with an easy grin. Mom looked over, noticing you at the foot of the stairs as well. Oh, I didn't expect you to come down already, Dae. I just wanted to let you know what was happening. I'm gonna call you out. Well, if I hadn't come now, then I wouldn't have heard everything you just said. Ooh, you got caught, Pam. What? You were saying things, too. I didn't say anything I wouldn't have told to Dae directly. Oh, you're unbelievable. You shook your head at your parents, even as you fought a blush when you remembered what just they'd been discussing. All right, you got me. I'm sorry for being gossipy and saying that about your friend. I can be bad, too. Well, get out of your way now. Mom sighed in mock defeat and made her way down the hall. Ma followed after her with a hushed giggle. Now you were alone in the living room. Tass was waiting for Cove. And that was just fine with you. If it hadn't been so hot outside, you would have visited him at his house a long time ago. You took a seat at the kitchen counter and settled in for the wait. As expected, there was a knock on the door a few minutes later. Hey, homie, what's up? When you got caught up and answered it, your neighbor was standing on the other side. He came in once you stepped aside to let him pass, giving a little wave. You greet him as you typically did. Ooh, with a wave, with a low five, with a nudge to the shoulder, with a noogie, with a hug. Ooh. Wave, boring. Nudge, maybe. I'll be on. A hug? Okay, we'll do a hug. Oh my god, best friend. Don't make that face while I'm hugging you. He stiffened in your arms and relaxed seconds after. One would think he'd be used to your hugs after all these years. Hey. His voice was cracked as he struggled to say something. You didn't feel worried about that. It was how he usually reacted when you were close by. Cove sighed and wiped at his face a bit. You noted the sheen of sweat across his brow. He must be glad to be back in the air-conditioned place, even if he only had to walk across the street to get there. Hell yeah. We always down for hugs here. Like give him a classic Dae bear hug, you know? Is something going on? Why'd you want to come over? I don't want to do anything. Not when it's like this. He gestured vaguely to the human air hanging around. I thought I could at least do nothing with you. Ah, hell yeah, doing nothing together, that's the best. I thought it was really sweet. His words were nice and expressed real fondness for you, in a strange sort of way, which was usually the case with Cove. Have you had lunch yet? I was gonna do it soon. He shook his head. I haven't really felt like eating because of the heat. I probably should have lunch. I didn't have breakfast this morning. What? You didn't eat at all, then you gotta have something now. Exactly. You gotta eat, bitch. You urged Cove into the direction of the kitchen. He stumbled after you. Food is fuel. And if you don't give your body fuel, it ain't gonna do its job. As one, you headed into the kitchen. You crossed your arms, you glance around, wondering what you should scrounge up for a meal. I don't want to eat anything that's warmed up. Is there something cold or not cooked? Yeah. After a bit of back and forth, the two of you concluded that you should raid the fridge and cabinet in order to make sandwiches. With that settled, you had planned to decide on the outside layers first. There was a wide variety to choose from, since everyone in your house had their own favorites. There was white bread, wheat bread, sourdough, mixed grains, gluten-free bread, and pita pockets. Could you take the grain one for me? Sure. You reached for the mixed grains and then made your decision. I like a good... Where's the wheat bread? There's no wheat bread. You just said there was wheat bread. Where's my wheat bread at? Hey, I mean, oh my gosh, Jack, you're eating with us. Your own sandwich. Everybody getting a sandwich. Well, I do. Lettuce wrap wouldn't be too bad. Just give me the classic white bread. You pulled out the white bread too, setting both items onto the counter. Then you had to decide what main directions the sandwich would go in. Savory. Ew, no sweet. Something savory would make it feel like a real meal. As for the specific ingredients, ooh, I want turkey, I want lettuce, tomato. Let's see. Mozzarella! Ham and mayo. Ooh, nice. I'm getting a little hungry. I should eat something here soon. I have some leftover enchilada in the fridge I can heat up. I may eat that during stream, depending. Let's see. Is that all I want on here? I don't really want anything else. I don't need hummus. I don't... Onions make me blow up. Nothing that's good. Condiments. For the finishing touch, you intended to top your sandwich with mayonnaise. And a little bit of salt and pepper. That was everything. You nodded to yourself with a quiet hum, satisfied. Excuse me. I was gonna do a lettuce wrap, but I think I would prefer like a crispy chicken to be in the wrap instead of just like turkey slices. So, the white bread it is. Classic sandwich. The two of you bustled around the kitchen, opening and closing things in order to collect everything you needed for your individual sandwiches. You focused intently on assembling your own, for the most part. When you were close to being done, though, you glanced over at your neighbor. Cove was putting his sandwich together delicately, his brow furrowed and tongue sticking out just barely. Making sandwiches? They require a lot of concentration. There are open jars of peanut butter and honey near his plate, as well as a banana peel. So he was making peanut butter, banana, and honey sandwich on mixed grain bread. It's a sandwich. It wasn't that surprising. More interesting. Yeah, classic peanut butter banana sandwich. I used to detest peanut butter with a burning passion in my soul when I was a cub. But now that I'm a little bit older now, and my taste buds have changed, I don't really mind peanut butter as much as I used to. I don't like it as much to like just have like a sandwich just made of that, you know. But I can eat a little bit of it. But a peanut butter sandwich is like too much for me. No peanut butter for me. So, no thoughts. Just sandwich. Here, as satiated, you turned back to your plate and finished your own creation. By the time you were done, Cove had already cleaned up his workstation. He turned to face you, sucking your sandwich briefly. A small smile tugged at the corners of his mouth. You guess it didn't look inedible to him, at least. Done? Yeah. Cool. He waited as you quickly returned the ingredients and cleaned a few utensils. Then the two of you collected your respective plates. You both agreed on heading upstairs to hang out in your room. PB and Milo is my fave. Oh, like a peanut butter and marshmallow sandwich. Like the marshmallow fluff. Okay, that sounds pretty good. I think I could eat like a peanut butter sandwich if it was like in like tiny bites. Like I said, not a lot. I like peanut butter crackers. Like the sandwich crackers. I do like those. I think I actually have some in my house right now. I bought like a pack of like a variety of crackers. Sandwich cracker pack. There was like one that was cheese, one that was peanut butter, and one that was like sour cream and chive? Cream cheese? And onion? I don't know. Something like that. I could have that with my little enchilada too. I don't know if that really goes together, but you know. He waited as you quickly returned the ingredient. Okay, I already said that. I was going to comment that. I would never do that in real life. I mean, I should, but typically when I make things, I kind of leave the mess as is and just wait till later to clean it back up. So good on these two, Cove and the day in this game, for cleaning up. You and Cove entered your bedroom while balancing your food on the plates. Nothing fell, so it was a successful trip. Cove took a seat on the ground, stretching out on the hardwood floor in an attempt to keep it a bit cooler. He immediately took a big bite of his sandwich, chewed, and then hummed happily. This sandwich was really good. At least that's something. At this point, you sat down and started on your own sandwich. A delicioso. Obviously, you're a pro at making sandwiches. Food first. Eat later. Or clean first. Nah, I'm food first, clean later. It's time to eat. He leaned back on his hands while chewing and glanced around.